Okay. All right, I'm dancing through some wonderful hoops here this morning. The storm is coming in, right? So, welcome everyone to this wonderful full stop in the wow video. I'm turned the corner now, okay? And we're starting to build up momentum here, so it's like a wonderful time actually. So I have a great announcement to make that I'm going to lead a 2 month intensive, or present a 2 month intensive. Let's say I like the term like present a 2 month intensive opportunity. November 21st through January 21st. This is being done at the request of the Dharma Kings, especially Longchenpa. He wants me to do this. He says this will be very helpful, and so the indications are that this is something that is really important to do. And so I said, okay, this morning I said, why not? I can do it. So I can do it. I will do it. It's already done. For my mind now, it's like, okay, it's like to the point where it's a done deal. We're going to do this. Full stop in the WOW intensive. So that's really great news. So we'll just move forward with this. It's through Inauguration Day, which is January 20th, the United States inaugurates a new president. So this is a time in the next 2 months. It's a very, very, very iffy time in the world. So but for us, it's just the opposite. We're just going to power through it. So I'm going to be presenting this intensive mostly here on YouTube, the videos on YouTube, which provide a different experience than Facebook. I'm not really pleased with Facebook. I've gotten no traction there whatsoever. And it is what it is, Facebook. Whereas YouTube, we have these longer videos. You can really feel the sense of progress and commitment and something happening here, intense. It's a more immersive 360-degree experience for us. So I have the capacity to put up all sorts of spiritual entertainment, which is an alternative to worldly entertainment. So during this intensive, we're going to watch our habits, be very mindful of our habits, and there's certain things that we want to temporarily for these 2 months to push away from us as we go through these dark days of November, December into January. Not much sunlight, gets dark at 4:30, at least from the northern hemisphere, where most of the viewers are. And so we look to some sort. What do we do with all these hours? Well, we look for entertainment. So you have to be very, very careful right now, and trust in the gurus. The gurus are rescuers. They are psychological rescuers. Longchenpa has promised when we left this world. He addressed future generations and said, "I promise, if you call upon me, I will respond." Okay, I will respond either in dreams or visions or actually physically present. And he's making good on his promise. So I have enough faith in Longchenpa to push through this 2 month intensive on his behalf, preparing us to get closer to the guru and accept the guru. Now, so we have the opportunity here to do a longer video now. I'm back to this commitment to longer videos here. I'm through my Facebook phase at this point, so I won't be doing any side projects at this point for the next couple months. I'm clearing the decks for the next couple months. It's going to be full-on focus. We'll see what Longchenpa will do. I don't have any expectations he'll do this or that. I'm going to do my best and just see what happens. This is part of trusting in the gurus, having faith. And having faith is all important. Okay, without faith, we flounder. We drown. We psychologically drown. Because this world is dedicated to absurdity, actually. Actually, it is dedicated to absurdity. So, for a moment, as we talk about the context of this intensive, what's the devil that we need to work on is absurdity, our attraction to absurdity. And entertainment is used by absurdity to code itself in you know, attractive form. So we keep being attracted to the logic of absurdity, which is like psychological suicide. And so we have to turn away from the glitter of the world, the entertainment of the world. But we're so used to entertainment, it's going cold turkey is very difficult for us at this time. In ancient times, it was a different story. He grew up in cultures where all entertainment was centered, dharma centered, spiritual centered on the guru, in the ashrams and the temples and the churches, and that's where you went for it. And this is very important. This is how we have to get back to that. Ultimately, we've gone way far away from what we need to do as a culture, putting our faith in absurdity and the ability to razzle dazzle of technology, thinking that if we could just dress absurdity up, you know, in a beautiful enough way, that it won't be absurd anymore. Right? So I'm just sort of introducing this 360 degree context of there's an intensive going on. Purpose of the intensive: help us get more comfortable with the presence of the gurus. There are rescuers. Drowners, the logic of absurdity says when you're drowning, if nobody comes to help you, everything must be okay. So absurdity tries to push away help. That's its whole purpose, push away help. And you notice this in the world right now. There's this massive effort to push away the gurus. It's just massive. They say, no, we don't need gurus anymore. You know, I'm good enough for you. So I'm different. I say, I'm not good enough for you. I'm not. I can help us get ready for the gurus, but I'm not good enough for you. The gurus, you deserve the best, and the gurus are the best. They're the ones that can rescue us psychologically from the logic of absurdity. Absolutely they can. So the secular world, the spirit of the age is to turn away from the gurus and believe that your smartphone's going to rescue you. Yeah, like that. It's disastrous, to say the least. So let's this intensive. I'm capable of presenting this, and the objective is we will be much more comfortable at the end of it, much more comfortable with the presence of gurus, presence of a guru. For instance, we'll say, you know what, I know how to get down to business. I won't be starstruck. We don't want to be starstruck. We'll realize, hey, the guru's here to rescue us, psychologically rescue us. And to do that, we have to get down to business. We have to be disciplined. We have to be right-minded, the good habits. There's all that to it. So we become less and less distracted and pulled back into absurdity. And ultimately, we let go of absurdity, okay? We let go of it. We let go of magic and wishful thinking, which are what drives our attachment to absurdity, really. And I'm confident we can do this. I'm very confident in the gurus. I've been confident my entire life. And they've given me reason to remain confident in them. Even though in this world it's not easy, because we're very leery. We've been taught to be leery of the real rescuers by false ones coming in and muddying up the whole scene. But, you know, we're beyond that at this point. You know, we have a necessity to take an abundance of caution right now. And I'm sure many of you feel this and you realize, hey, I'm not going to gamble with this period of my life. I'm going to take the sure thing, which is mental discipline, mindfulness. That's, you know, psychological health. I'm going to apply psychological health instead of psychological absurdity. Now, psychological absurdity seems to be fun at first, but it's not so fun later on, okay, to say the least. So abundance of caution. We're going to take an abundance of caution. I'll roll this out as we go along. Now, maybe nobody will take this intensive. That's possible. Most intensives, maybe one person has taken it, maybe nobody, but I still do it. I still do it. So don't think if nobody does it, I'll quit. That's absurdity. That's absurdity. I will do it myself for sure. It's already done in my mind. It's a commitment. Okay. I'm going to do it. So just wow that, full stop in the wow intensive, where we will experience so much wow that we need to be committed to whatever arises, do nothing about it for a little while. That's the wow commitment. I'm not going to do anything. I'm not going to put it into any form at all or definition. I'm not going to define it at all. I'm just going to say wow. Okay. Now, that gives us just this extremely abstract definition, right, of the definition of no definition, which is fine. That's good enough. Jesus tells us there's an intermediate goal. It's good enough. Don't let the ego trick you in saying, well, that's not totally, you know, totally. Oh, you, total abstraction, we couldn't even remain in this world. Okay, so it's a foolish, that's absurdity talking. Just wow it. Just wow it. Don't put it into any definition other than wow. And hold on to that definition of just wow, which is really a 360-degree definition. It's 360-degreeness. Now, I know I'm talking fast here because I want to get this out. Starting on Monday, 21st, the intensive starts. I had a series of miracles yesterday that just pointed it out. It was so astonishing, actually. How, you couldn't have scripted it, you know. I mean, this is like God was scripting it, no question. And again, I don't know what kind of support I'll get. I have hopes, but you know, I don't want to get my expectations. I don't want to build expectations. That causes problems. So I just say, you know what? I'm going to do my best and let the chips fall where they may. And that's how it'll go. By the end of these 2 months, I will have done the intensive, okay? And I'll be way better off for it, unquestionably. And that's the bottom line, isn't it? Don't let absurdity play with your thoughts, okay? Don't let absurdity play with your motivation. This is our trouble. What is absurdity? Absurdity is the belief that a false premise can be transformed if we're just logically consistent with it for a long enough time and in an extreme enough way. If we just remain relentlessly consistent with a false premise, absurdity says that the premise will change. And the premise will then be true. This is totally contrary to the laws of creation. Okay. The premise is never changed by the effect. Cause is never changed by the effects. A premise is never altered by the effects of the premise. By the logic of the premise. That's called creation. That's called reality. So absurdity is contrary to reality. The goal of absurdity is to change reality. Plain and simple. And we're the ones that chose this. No devil or Satan chose it for us. We chose it for ourselves. So we're totally in control of choosing again, choosing something different, choosing, all right, healed perception, healed logic, healed psychology. Say no, letting go of absurdity, okay, and choosing non-absurdity, non-absurdity. So in an intensive, we are mindful, we have to say, okay, good habits, 360-degree good habits, in all ways. So it's kind of, we want to be, January 21st, we want to hit the ground running, okay? We want to be just like shining, you know, and say, you know what? The gurus don't scare me. I would welcome their presence here. The gurus are the great rescuers, the heavyweights. Okay, they can swim out to ocean, pull you out of a stormy ocean, bring you to shore, and revive you easily. Easy. So, we need rescuing right now, psychological rescuing. We do. There's no question about it. I wouldn't be pushing this so intensely if I had any doubt about it at all. We live in a culture of absurdity. We live in a world of absurdity, which is desperately following the belief that consistent loyalty to an absurd premise will make the premise true. And this is what's happening in the New World Order, and everything that's happening in the world right now is really we're following absurdity. Okay. And so everybody's trying to make sure that everybody says, let's stay on the same page here. Look, if we all get on the same page, we're all consistent with loyally and consistent with absurdity, absurd premise. If we just keep following, I'm consistent, I keep doing the same thing over and over and over, hit my head against the wall, that will transform the premise. This will never happen. This will never happen. It will never happen. So we're just wasting our time. We're just aimlessly drifting about aimlessly. Even though it seems that we're very purposeful here in the world right now. We're not. We are not. Much ado about nothing in the world right now. So, as I said, entertainment is used to hook you into the teeth of absurdity and feel like I'm going along with absurdity isn't such a bad thing. We can dance along with it, you know. That's what it's used for in the world. It's very vicious entertainment. And yet, we feel a craving for it, don't we? So, I'm trying to put together videos that are entertaining enough for you so that you say, hey, you know, I can go over here and still be entertained. This is how the Dharma works. This is how the Holy Spirit works, the grace of God works. Throughout history, all the entertainment was centered in spiritual context. So like church and Christianity, all art and entertainment could only be presented through the church. Okay, this is how it was. Very wise. And therefore, if you wanted the craving for entertainment, you would go to church. Okay, same thing around the world. So the artist painted beautiful paintings and did beautiful sculptures and did all this stuff. But it was all these religious themes, all these spiritual themes, and was presented in the church, just like in Tibetan Buddhism, all the beautiful tankas and mandalas and all the gorgeous, you know, artwork they do, and the sublime, very sublime crafts and artwork and artistry, etc. That's only presented in the, you know, the monasteries and the areas of teaching. You have to go there, pretty much, to see it. The religious ceremonies. So it attracts you to the truth, to the towards the gurus, the rescuers. It attracts you towards it. Whereas, so in Tibetan Buddhism, they call samaya, which means don't share all this stuff with just everybody willy-nilly. You need to keep it within the context of the Dharma and use it to attract people to the Dharma. Now, because of the collapse of our culture in the world culture into absurdity now, because of technology, we think that we can empower absurdity, actually, and change the premise, which we can't. Because of that, I've been trying to help people, saying, hey, look, there's some help in putting out for graphics and a lot of different stuff. Just make it available to everyone. But very few, it's self-selective, very few pay attention. It's self-selective, I found. But I'm understanding Samaya much better now. And so we're going back towards what works. We took this side trip, an excursion to what doesn't work, which is modern culture, and we're going back to what does work. And that means that the sublime will be presented within the ashrams, within the temples, within the churches, within the Dharma centers, the monasteries, etc. And in order to have access to it, you will have to go there. Now, I don't know how virtual access works. I don't know exactly how this all works, because now people do it, you know, wherever you are, on your phones or laptops or computers. I'm not sure how that will work. Maybe I should say only those who sign up for the intensive are able to see the what I put up. That's possible. I might do that. We're working towards that. You know, I can make videos private. I think I can have like 30 people on my list that they're able to then to see the videos. I have to invite them, or if it's unlisted, I invite people. I put a list of a video, new video. And then you can go see it like that. I might do that. But I'm not sure how that'll work out. But we need to start going in that direction. Because what I found on Facebook is that this constant sharing of all this various stuff, we're losing our motivation. But I'm seeing the most crucial aspect of our path is motivation. So I'm very keen to look at motivation. And I understand that the gurus have always used motivation as central. And Samaya is basically saying, we don't want to lose motivation. So the people have to feel like, hey, if we want something sublime, we have to start taking some retreats and start getting into the Dharma. Otherwise, it's not available to us. This is, I believe, the proper approach, because this works on the level of motivation. Without motivation, we're sunk. And so on Facebook, just all the stuff's just present, easy. Yeah, okay, click, 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 click. And then, okay. And I see in the world, people have lost their motivation. And I see me losing my motivation on Facebook. It's not such a big deal anymore. It's like, oh yeah, it's just, you know, you go to a dime store and pick up a guru or something. And so you lose your discipline, you lose your determination, you know, it's just easy come, easy go type of thing. I don't see how that's helping anyone very much, or actually. I see it undermining our motivation, undermining it. So, and I've always said the greatest blessing God has given me is poverty. And because there's no easy come, easy go. If I got the GoPro camera, that was like just an enormous decision for me, because I can't do anything else now. Yeah, that's all the money I had in the world. And I said, well, I got it. Now I got to use it. It's a commitment. You make a commitment, and then you start following through on it, which I have been doing. I've been just intensely producing videos, right? Because I made it this all-in commitment. When I bought a Course in Miracles back in 1978, it was $35 plus tax. It was all the money I had in the world. I didn't have a penny left over. And I hesitated for a month. I said, I can't do this. What if I spend all my money? What I won't be able to do anything else, you know. Not that you can do anything for $35, but I just, the feeling like I, you know. But I finally was being bothered by dreams so badly, I had to go do it. And it was all the money I had in the world. And I, you know, didn't have a penny. I reached a point I didn't even have a penny left, my own personal money at all. I was living at home, but I had no money. And that was it. But I had enough to get by A Course in Miracles. So I was very committed to it, profoundly committed to it. I spent the next 15 years of my life sitting in a room, studying it, you know, and applying it and practicing and getting familiar with it. I spent 15 years intensely getting familiar with it. And then I went to Journey Beyond Words and spent a year intensely getting used to that. And then I've continued with that throughout the years, on and off, but also inner work of familiarity of getting simplifying it all. But I was totally committed to it, you see, because it was the only possession I could afford in the world, A Course in Miracles, at that point. That was it. I didn't have anything else. I couldn't afford anything else, you know. Just so that was my baby. Yeah, that was like my child. And so I paid utmost attention to it. Never was without it. It was always by my side. It's like someone like say buys a guitar, yeah, acoustic guitar, with all the money they have in the world, a young person, that's it. They don't have anything else. And now that guitar then becomes like their child, and they may just carry it with them wherever they go and practice. I used to be that way too. So poverty affords this opportunity for commitment. And so it's very motivating. It's fantastic. And looking back, I realized that's the greatest blessing anyone could possibly have is poverty, not destitution, but poverty. So you're close to destitution, but not in it. And so the things that come into your life, whatever comes into your life, you value it greatly, and you really get into it, and you really use it, and you're very determined. Where easy come, easy go, if you're a multimillionaire, you could just buy a million books, you know. I'll read this book. I'm not that interested. I'll buy another one. I couldn't do that. Ultimately, I could go to the library. But for me, you know, I bought A Course in Miracles, all the money I had in the world. And so that was my vehicle. That was my ride. That was my ticket home. So I would spend, you know, up 14, 16 hours a day reading and studying all day, every day. That's all I did. I was too ill to work at that time. And that's all I did for you know, decade and a half, you might say, really. I mean, it's pretty much, I did some other stuff. Eventually, I started working some other stuff in. But, I mean, you're talking about massive commitment, full commitment, because of the poverty. And I couldn't go anywhere. I was not well enough to go anywhere. But you know, if I had money to go to Hawaii, I probably would have gone and stayed in a hotel. Let me be sick and lie on the beach or something. And I ultimately, I would have turned into a globetrotter. I would have done anything but spend 16 hours a day with A Course in Miracles, right? So God saw to it that I had no opportunity to do these things but through poverty. And I remain poor. Like right now. Can't even pay the bills exactly, really. am I right on the edge of not being able to pay? And yet I'm not destitute. I still have food. I still have a roof over my head. Managed to have vehicles. I still drive them around. I haven't played golf more than twice in the last 14 months. For me, it's too expensive. I can't really afford it. But we'll see if that changes. I don't know. It's poverty really puts you under this marvelous pressure. The most spiritually unfortunate people in the world are wealthy people, without question. I'm around a lot of wealthy people, and easy come, easy go. They're able to distract themselves constantly. As soon as things start getting a little nervous, oh, I'll take a vacation. I'll buy this. I'll trade in my car and get a new model, a new toy. They're always distracting themselves. It's the worst possible situation to be in, is to be wealthy, actually. Pity the wealthy. I really pity them. They're so miserable. They're so spiritually weak. Psychologically vulnerable. Horrible. Best people I meet in the world are people who have been poor in their lives, and you can just tell the dignity of commitment in them. Rich people, they can get divorced, get a new spouse, go do this many times, whatever, gallivant about. You can't do that when you're poor. They can have lawsuits, they can sue people. I can't do any of that stuff. I can't do any of that stuff. I could basically just, do a little bit of taping, which is what I do. I could make it, as economical as possible. Even my equipment is very cheap. This computer is very old that I use. I'm committed to it. I'll use it and use it and use it and use it and use it. And it's content that matters, okay? But in today's society, in disposable society, is all about distraction. It's all about and faith and magic, distraction, faith and magic, distraction, faith and magic. Faith and magic means the belief that effects can change the cause. That's what it means. And the fact is, this will never happen. So the path of magic and wishful thinking and dreaming and belief and all that, it's nothing. There's no effect from it. So we're waiting for this effect, we're waiting for the cause to change. It will never change. So we're really waiting for nothing at all to happen, right? How absurd is that? Very absurd. So the gurus rescue us psychologically, we could say. They help us ultimately recognize absurdity for what it is and just say, that can't touch me. I can't be touched by absurdity at all. An image, a belief in a screen doesn't alter the screen. We heard that everything is just appearance on the screen of pure consciousness. Yes, even the belief, the idea or thought of a screen of pure consciousness is appearing on the pure screen of consciousness, just the same as anything else. There's no difference at all between the idea of pure consciousness and the idea of delusion or absurdity. There's no difference. They're both appearing equally on the screen of pure consciousness. There's no differentiation to make. And to try to differentiate where it's the same is absurdity. And to try to make the same, different is absurdity. And try to make what is different the same is absurdity. Right? So it's... Now, most will not take the intensive. Most will not be prepared by January 21st. And most will be falling into desperation. So we certainly have to have some nexus, some hub started to start pulling in be first responders to these, psychologically destitute people who are just saying, I just can't take it anymore. I don't know what to do. And so the idea is there's this hub. We're going to set up a hub where the gurus are the center of the hub. And around that hub, the spokes go out in 360 degrees. And that's like spokes of attraction that attract minds in from 360 degrees into some sort of reconstitution of their psychology. where they begin to realize they have the tools to get free of absurdity. Now, yesterday I had this experience very briefly, and I saw how it's so easy to actually liberate yourself, be liberated. And I just noticed this. It just started to happen in me, and I just said, okay. I said, all right, it's there. I didn't try to grasp it or do it or anything. I was just made aware of it. Very simple and very easy. So the tools, our liberation is so easy and simple, actually. So easy and simple. However, to those who are loyal to absurdity, nothing is easy or simple. It's all wildly complex. So when people say, well, is the path easy? You know, it's both yes and no, right? Yes, if you see it as easy, but if you see it in an absurd context, it is extremely difficult. And since we're loyal to absurdity, and since we have this terrible continuity fear, which makes us loyal to absurdity, the path is very difficult. So we don't need to keep tilting at the windmills of words, okay? This is definitive here. Okay, truth is definitive. The gurus are definitive. So I'm loyal to the gurus. So I speak in a definitive way. And if you know people have trouble with that, that's continuity fear. Okay, it's continuity fear. The path is very difficult because of continuity fear. Plain and simple. And everyone has severe continuity fear here, and except for the gurus. Okay, and if you don't feel perfect, you're not a guru. Okay, so you have severe continuity fear. If you don't feel perfect all the time, I mean flawless, no trace of fear at all, then you're not a guru, which means you have severe continuity fear. So severe continuity fear keeps pushing us towards absurdity, and that makes things wildly complex for us. Okay, and then we keep trying to struggle out of absurdity by word games, mind games. That never works. That itself is absurd. That's like floundering. So we get out of absurdity not by struggling with absurdity, okay, but by full stop in the wow. No definition, no answer, no definition. We're committed to no answer, no definition of any answer, just wow. We wow our success. We don't define it. This is our commitment on this intensive. We wow our success. We do not define it. Easy. As long as we do it. As soon as we go back to absurdity, it becomes wildly complex again, and we're back in mind games. And then it's, oh, this is so difficult. But as soon as we wow it, the difficulty disappears. And we say, oh, it's easy. So the truth is, it's either going to be very easy for you or wildly difficult and complex. That's the choice we have to choose between. So during these times where the world is wildly difficult and complex, isn't it very reasonable to say, well, I'm at least going to have something in my life that's very easy. I'm going to afford myself that luxury. So this is the luxury of poverty, you might say. I can afford myself massive luxuries, the luxury of this easy path of a full stop in the wow. Actually, I'm amazingly wealthy. Because I can afford myself stuff the wealthy could never. The wealthy are constantly trying to get more wealth and buy more things and manage their wealth to make it more. Whereas I don't have any of that. I don't have any wealth to manage. And I could just full stop in the wow right now, you see. Or as they say, no, I have to get this toy. Just a car. Yeah, I got five of them. I can get another. I'll get another one soon. I'll trade this one, and I'm thinking about trading that one. And they're always thinking about their toys, about their comforts, about their remodeling their next houses, the purchases, the deals. You see, it's nonstop, isn't it? It's nonstop. When do they ever stop to pay attention to their psychological health? Never. That's always later. Once they get happy through their wealth, the materiality. Yet all the while they're being loyal to absurdity. And happiness with absurdity is always later. Always when the cause is transformed, then you'll get the happiness. But until then, you don't get it. So that's absurdity. Absurdity always offers you this pie-in-the-sky later happiness contingent upon effects changing the cause. It's all contingent upon that. And the only way you get that, absurdity says, is you have to be loyal. You have to continue to be loyal to absurdity. This is a trap. This is a cult. This is a dead end, complete dead end. And yet we're so unhappy in this. Absurdity says, well, just get more material things. That'll do it for you. That'll do it for you. That'll do it for you. Just get more wealthy, more wealth, more wealth. You know, better special relationships. You know, this, and have more kids. You know, be a good soldier. You know, just stay loyal to absurdity, the goals of absurdity, and you'll ultimately, you will succeed. And when you die, don't worry, you'll get your reward for being loyal and, you know, and all this kind of stuff. Well, it may be easy to get a glimpse of paradise when you die, but staying there is a difficult part, right? Who stays there? Very few stay there in the pure lands because of cravings. They come back because of cravings, right? Cravings is what kill you, bring you back to the killing fields, which is, this world is just simply the killing fields, and your cravings bring you back here. Absurdity brings you back here, and your cravings, you know, where's this? I'm used to this, you know, the food, the alcohol, the vices of all sorts, the entertainments. I got to get those, you know, but I don't, in paradise, I can't feed my cravings, so they leave and come back to the world. This is well known. So abidance in paradise, abidance in the pure lands is what our goal is. Certainly after we leave this world, we will want to be abiding in paradise and not return here, not compulsively return here. Okay, no compulsive return here. We can return as a guru or in service to a guru, but it's not a compulsive return at all. It's not an absurdist return. You don't return in absurdity, in any loyalty to absurdity whatsoever. Okay? That's our goal, and we will reach that goal. I certainly will, and those who apply themselves will certainly do so. But it requires, you must afford yourself the easy path, all right? And who is doing that? Very few in the world, right? Who is affording themselves the easy path of full stop and the wow? That is the easy path, which is, however you label it, it's the same, okay? Which is, you don't define your success. You do not define it, certainly initially. When something arises, well, you realize, wow, this is clearly a great advancement. You're aware of it. You say, oh my gosh. Don't define it. Do not define it. Do not put it into any form. Let it remain 360-degree abstract. Wow. Just wow, wow. That's it. You don't even need to say, I just had an experience. You know you had experience. You don't need to define it any further. Just say, wow, wow. So let that be your first reaction. It's just wow. And this then precludes any absurdist struggle with definition, right? Isn't all definition an absurdist struggle? Ultimately, sure it is. Now, we're not banning ourselves from all definition. We're just saying the first step in definition is it has to be the wow. And then once the continuity fear is evaporated around this experience that has arisen, you will find that you really don't need to define it so much. It's just that initial knee-jerk reaction is what we have to focus on. If we knee-jerk ourselves into definition, we're going to block ourselves and we're going to have a rough ride, because then we're going to put it into an absurdist context. And then the struggle arises. Okay, so the knee-jerk reaction has to be wow. Okay, wow. It started to rain. Intermittent showers today. And this is the whole discipline. And this is the discipline that most in the world are utterly failing. They'll say, no, no, no. First, I'll go along. The easy way is to go along with what I'm used to, which is wild complication. Now, ask yourself, is that really the easy way? This is the crux of the whole question. Is going along with what we're familiar with really the easy way, if what we're familiar with is wild complication and confusion? Wild complication, let's say. How can that be the easy way just because it's familiar? That's absurdity, isn't it? Whereas if we full stop in the wow, they say, well, I'm not used to doing that. It's so difficult. Well, there's a tiny bit of difficulty initially by deciding to do it, but you have to will, you just say, okay, I'll do this. And then, wow. And then you say, oh, that was easy. So the absence of difficulty, we must not make say it's difficult. We must say that it's a continuity fear reaction. Okay. And we don't struggle with it. We just patiently sit, which is easy. It's easy to sit here like this. I'm not struggling. So we accept there's the continuity fear reaction, which we have to use will on that. Not thinking, not struggle, but will. So without the right use of will, you know, we've handicapped ourselves, and we're back in the wild struggle of absurdity. Now, we may think going fast in the wild struggle of absurdity, I go real fast in it, that somehow that'll work. No. That just ultimately leads to a mental breakdown, nervous breakdown. But absurdity keeps telling us, it's too difficult to do full stop in the wild. It's too difficult. Well, to absurdity it is, but we're not absurd. Okay. So absurdity is saying to us, that's too difficult for me. That's too difficult for me. I only understand wild complexity and commotion and struggle. I understand panicked struggle. That's it. Because that's what I am. I can't do that, absurdity says. Well, we're not asking absurdity to do that. We're not absurdity. We're doing it. We're spirit. So it's easy for spirit to do this. And absurdity says, well, what about me? You got to take me along for the ride. No, we don't. Absurdity is just a wild struggle. It's not an entity. Absurdity is just a false premise. That premises can be changed by their effects. That's a false premise. And even a false premise cannot be changed by its effects at all. So there's no entity. There's no egoic entity at all. It's just a wild struggle, a panic struggle is all. There's no entity we need to please. The trouble we've gotten into is projecting all these notions of entity-ness upon this wild struggle and thinking that if we just pray to this entity-ness, that this wild struggle will be successful and we'll be able to change the premise. And so we've projected gods and goddesses and demigods and demigoddesses and forces and we're constantly praying to these. There's none of that is true. None of that is true. There's no entity-ness to the wild struggle, wild magical struggle at all. It's none. Continuity fear is not an entity. So we must be very careful not to try to worship and pray to non-existent entities like this, trying to help us make absurdity work. Okay, but of course many are used to that, right? It's like we can't say, God, 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 please change the premise. These effects are just killing me. Just change the premise and then I'll be happy. God can never do such a thing because that would be changing God. So there is no God that listens to those type of prayers. That doesn't mean there isn't a God. Of course there is. But God is the law and the rule of creation. We can't change that. We cannot. So we don't need to have absurdity along for the ride. It's not. There's no entity. There's no God there. There's no spirituality. There's no entity there at all. There's nothing to go along on a ride with at all. It's imaginary. But for a while, we might think that there's something there. But gradually, we become more and more comfortable. There's nothing there. You know, this idea of Jehovah, you know, is the tribal God, which, you know, is prayed to so that we can, you know, slaughter our enemies and take over their lands. You know, this is an imaginary entity. It's a projection upon absurdity. Oh, it's a magical wishful thinking. Of course, our mind is all powerful, and so we can, in our absurdity, in our wild struggle, we can arrange all sorts of outcomes, right? One way or the other, and then say, oh no, God did that for me. God did help me defeat my enemies. That's just a struggle, the wild, chaotic struggle of absurdity. There's no entity there. So there's no reason to take absurdity along the ride for us. So once we see that, we get to feel like, I could just full stop in the wild myself right now. But see, most say, no, I can worship God, but I can't full stop in the wow. But the God they're worshiping is the God of absurdity, is attempt to deify absurdity. That's what's really going on. So that's why they don't do full stop in the wow. They say, no, I don't have permission to do that. In other words, they're saying absurdity won't give me permission. But there's no entity to either give or not give permission with absurdity. It's a dance of continuity fear. It's just this dance of chaotic, hysterical, panicked confusion and contradiction and complexity. That's all it is. There's no entity there. There's no spiritual entity there. We're the spiritual entity, the one who can say, no, I'm going to just do full stop in the wow. And when you do it, you say, wow, I did it. And absurdity disappeared. It didn't attack me, you know, like I thought it would. And then when it comes back, I realize I asked it back out of continuity fear. It has no power over me, actually. It has zero power over me. There's no entity there at all. I don't need to struggle with some entity. I don't need to kill the ego. There's no ego, egoic identity, entity or identity at all there. None. Just as we lose interest in it, it vanishes. Like it never was. Now, so I've gotten the heads up from the Holy Spirit, from the Dharma Kings, and from Longchenpa. Very clear, compelling heads up. Back away from Facebook right now. That's what I was told. Been told. Absolutely so. And I said, what do I do? I'm getting so used to it. I mean, when I'm bored, I'm sitting at the computer, what do I do? You know, there's no other way to interact with people really on the internet anymore. It's crazy. Although, I used to try all these forums and it just died. Everything just died, and the forums got taken over by one or two people who I just visited this thing on a discussion page recently. I mean, it was just a typical thing. A couple of, you know, posters, like four or five, that is all it is, and they just spend time arguing with each other. That's it. Calling each other names, getting into political arguments, right? And it was supposed to be a page dedicated to the highest spiritual wisdom. It just evaporates. People cannot stay with it, which they go back to absurdity. Everything there was just absurdist based. There's no full stop in the wow taking place at all. So this is the trouble when you, like on Facebook, and there's so many different friends and everything. Most of them are not going to keep you on point at all. They're going to pull you away from it, actually, because they themselves are not disciplined. They haven't accepted the intensive. When you accept an intensive, there's a duty for the others that are there also be in the intensive, so they help reinforce your mindfulness. You don't want a bunch of people distracting you away from your mindfulness. That's absurd. And of course, absurdity insists on equal billing. But I say there's no one to bill. There's no one to bill. There's no one there. Because absurdity bases its identity on a future occurrence. But we base our identity on right now. We're here right now. We're identity right now. Absurdity says, well, it has no identity now, but it will in the future once effects change the cause of the effects. And what we know is that will never happen. So absurdity will never have an identity. Therefore, it has no identity now at all. Zero. So how can zero ask for equal billing? How can nothing ask for equal billing? That's utterly absurd. It's based on a false premise. So it's really saying to stay loyal to absurdity. And how can that be equal? That's totally a cross purpose as to what we're doing. totally at cross purposes. So how can we allow cross purposes into our discipline? Then it's no discipline at all. It's absurdity again. You know, it's to spirit is completely obvious. To absurdity is never obvious. It's just always a struggle. Always a struggle. And this is what you get, and everyone's struggling. They're in absurdity then. I don't struggle that way so much anymore. I scratch my head a little bit and say, what's the matter with everyone in terms of, they're not practicing, are they? Obviously. They're still trying to find a way to remain loyal to absurdity, which for many people means looking at spiritual pictures and quotes, because that's feeding, trying to buy off that craving for reality, for truth, for spirit. They're trying to, you know, keep it quiet, like giving a dog some treats. You know, the dog starts barking, here, have a treat, have another treat, have another treat, have another treat. But they themselves are staying in absurdity. They're staying loyal to absurdity. No question about it. They're trying to placate, you know, appease their inner spiritual hunger by this superficial approach. But they themselves don't do full stop in the wow. They don't actually do that all-important step of saying of spirit deciding what to do instead of absurdity. They don't take that step yet. That's obvious to me that they haven't taken that step yet. Until you take that step, you're not really on the spiritual path. You're on the path of appeasement. That's an absurdist path. What you're saying is, we just got to hang in there a little longer until absurdity becomes the new identity, and then we'll be happy. We'll have an identity because we're used to absurdity. We don't have an identity yet, but we will soon as effects change the cause. And that never happens. It will never happen. So they go to their graves still grimly hoping, you know, and pumped up on drugs and ultimately morphine, and people have a little memorial and nobody talks about you really. Have a picture of you up there and everybody kind of ignores it actually. Went to a funeral yesterday. You know, wow. Funerals these days are just not what they used to be, I'll tell you that. I mean, the last two funerals, one was a great matriarch and the other was a great patriarch, you know, where they were the absolute authority in their families, disciplinary authoritarians. They both passed away about the same age, 68. And in both situations, everybody pretty much ignored them. I mean, they went through the motions, but you could tell they're happy they're gone because that authority in their life is gone. People hate authority now. These people kept them in line, the greater family, the clan. They kept them in line. They said, you don't do this in my family, okay? You don't do this. You have to have good habits. They insisted on them. They demanded them. And people are I just wish they will die, you know, so I can just do whatever the heck I want to do. I can chase after absurdity. And now they're gone, and the funeral, I was just dumbfounded by it all. I was just, you know, a peripheral person in their lives, to say the least, but I was the one that was most heartbroken and paid them the most respects, and, you know, I'm soulfully there for them. I still am. I've been since 40 days. And today I gave him great prayer for help. I said, thank you so much for the help you gave me in my life. And I'm not going to abandon you. I saw how all your family has abandoned you. And even one of the family members told me, he said, nobody cares at all. Shocking. He says, it's just deplorable. And I said, I see that. I see it. Yeah, you're right. But I'm outside his family and I only knew him for a little while. But he gave me, you know, hope and encouragement, and I saw he had repented and changed his life, and he wanted to put himself on a new path. He was full of cravings, but I'm not going to abandon him. I said, here's somebody that wants to do better and realizes they wasted their life and wants to get on the right spiritual track. So I'm giving him all this love and appreciation when he's in the afterlife now to get with the gurus, start a path towards the gurus who will rescue you from your cravings for sure. Cravings arise from absurdity. Trying to placate our spiritual craving for truth, for true functionality, instead of waiting for functionality, you know? We're waiting for absurdity to become this new God, a God of our own creation. And it will never be. It will never be so. And in fact, we've never even taken the first step in that direction. So there's no entity there. It's not like we're almost there. No, we've gone nowhere. We've gone nowhere. So instead of trying to figure out what is it like to be with a guru, just prepare. So I'm just this I'm an official presenter of Longchenpa in terms of Dharma Prince working to get us prepared that we can be in his presence. And again, you can be in the presence of one guru, you can be in the presence of all of them. It's like if you can play golf on a beautiful country club, private club, really, really well, and feel comfortable there, you can go to any beautiful golf course and play well there. Once you get over that feeling like I don't belong here kind of thing, if you feel you really belong, you can go to any place, actually. You project your confidence, your familiarity, and I can handle myself here, and people, they'll say, yeah, okay, great, fine. We you know, that's what we want here. We want people who self-responsible. They can monitor themselves. They can control their own actions. This is what you're looking for. You have your own discipline. You regulate yourself. You police yourself. You know, and we trust you. So we don't even need to worry about you. I'll just go out and play. We're not policing or looking out over your shoulder or anything. What a great feeling that is, I'm telling you, where people trust in you. And we lack trust in the world today. Silicon Valley, you can't trust anyone anymore the way they drive. We almost got killed several times yesterday. It's just because why? Everybody is only trying to get ahead of everybody else here. The hell with everyone else. It's all about me, 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 me. What can I get? I want to make my fortune secure, you know, my wealth so I can, you know, be wealthy. And everyone is out for themselves to get ahead of everyone else. That's it. Quote unquote, everyone. Okay. And so we're driving along and there's this railroad tracks, this commuter train. This is not a freight train that comes by once a week. Okay. This is a commuter track. The trains go through every 5 minutes or so. So this is a dangerous railroad track. So I saw this and I'm coming up to it and there's a traffic light just past it. The tracks, very bad place for a traffic light, right? So like a couple cars can stop in front of that traffic light and not be on the railroad tracks, okay? This is a really dangerous situation. I don't know why they have that. It's just crazy. So I saw that and I said, wow, I better stop back behind the tracks so I, you know, I don't get stuck on the tracks. And then the cars pulled up a little further and then I realized there's one more space there, obviously one more space. Now all the cars had stopped and I said, okay, I can go forward in my lane. There's two lanes going in the same direction. I can go across the tracks safely, get off the tracks, and be in that intermediate place there. So I start going across the tracks. You know what happens? Someone on the right lane there, where their lane was all backed up, they had no room to go across the tracks, they suddenly zoomed and cut in front of me and zoomed into that one slot, which left me basically on the tracks. Now, I wasn't quite on the tracks yet, but I was in that place where if the barrier comes down, it's going to hit the car. Now, that's about as vicious as you can get, isn't it, to do something like that? This has happened to me like twice now. That was the most blatant. It's gotten worse. You know, that's putting someone's life in severe danger, what they just did. So I was stuck, and the car behind me, you know, couldn't back up. I was stuck, you know, it was horrible. I don't know what the heck I could have done if a train came. I better think about it. And I think I looked at the car behind me, and they were like yelling. They could tell. I think they were upset at seeing what had happened. And I honked the horn and stuff. We were just like, you know, I was furious. It was like, that is just this. You cannot trust people. I mean, that is so untrustworthy, right? That was just one example of driving. I had to drive yesterday through the Bay Area. There are a number of other instances. Now, we're walking away from the funeral, the memorial service from the church. And there's a big crosswalk, obviously marked. And so we're all in a group, and we're walking across the crosswalk, and we're talking with one another about this intense, you know, funeral prayer service we just had. And I've got my head up, you know, because I just do when I'm out. I said, keep your head up and keep it moving because you can't trust anyone anymore in this area. You don't know what's going to happen. And so the people ahead of me were in conversation with one another. They weren't looking. They're going across the crosswalk, and everything was wide open. It's a no-brainer, right? Well, I look to the right, and I see this white pickup truck coming. Or maybe it was off-white, beige or something. And it's going really fast, and it's a little bit of a distance. And I just notice it. I think the Holy Spirit said, just notice this vehicle. So, okay, I noticed it. And then I say, hey, wait a minute. It's not slowing down. And then I suddenly put more attention on it. And I make a quick sermon. Is it slowing down or not? I say, it's getting close to the intersection here. And it hasn't slowed down at all. And then I realized that is. I said, you know what? I don't think it's going to stop. And so I yelled to the people ahead of me, say, hey, heads up. And they stop talking, and they stop walking. And this truck just zooms right through the intersection, right through the crosswalk. And wow, were they angry with the patriarch there, the guy. He screamed at the driver, cursing at him, you know. Because if I hadn't have yelled at them, they may have walked right in front of that truck and gotten killed. Okay? This is what we face in the Bay Area, is you literally escape death here on a daily basis because of the insane greed-driven minds here in this Bay Area. They may seem to be wealthy and well-dressed and educated, but they're monsters, okay, because they don't look out for anyone except themselves and their own me, 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 wealth, wealth, power, 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 okay? That's all. Now, this guy was a gardener. He was a Mexican gardener, Hispanic gardener, okay? And he was just, you know, just too long. And I guess he doesn't know how to drive here. Or he doesn't know about sidewalks, crosswalks. Like people in a crosswalk, you're supposed to slow down and stop. He's oblivious. And even he drove through, like, screaming at him. He's like, huh, what? I mean, there was like 15 people in the crosswalk, okay? And he didn't slow down at all. I mean, this is unthinkable, right? In the past. I mean, you're driving in this residential area. You drive, you're aware of pedestrians. You have to be aware of people, pedestrians around a church, around schools, crosswalks, people going, and people don't pay any attention in crosswalks these days. They're all on their smartphones, right? And they were going to walk right in front of this truck. It would have been several people killed probably coming out of a memorial. And just before we left, the cross above this person's ashes, box with their ashes, some ladies were doing something, and it fell, and it broke. And I said, uh-oh, better heads up. Better keep my head up here. Something as dangerous is going to happen. So I had my heads up leaving the chapel, and I saw that vehicle. You see, this is called mindfulness. God gives us these warnings. And, you know, people, I don't know if they know, maybe I saved their life or not. I don't know. I've had many situations like that where I've saved people's lives and they're oblivious to it. You know, oh, thanks. Because, you know, look out. I saved this one guy's life. Oh, man. Baseball game, you know. It was unbelievable what happened. I pushed him. Hey, pushed him. It would have hit him right in the temple, right in the head. It's baseball going like 100 miles an hour or more. It was just, you know, it was terrible. But I saw it coming where he was distracted. So, but especially in today's world where everybody's so distracted with their smartphones, it's very dangerous. And the attitude of greed, like in the Bay Area, it may be one of the worst places in the world without question. People are just fanatically focused on money, money, power, power, job. I've got to be promoted. They're just locked into this. Their whole lives have been locked in this educational system that is driven by greed, okay? And, of course, with the job situation, the world of the middle class getting killed by immigrant labor and third world labor and outsourcing of all our jobs, then the middle class being destroyed, so people are desperate now to make sure their children have the best education and compete. The number of jobs, good paying jobs, is shrinking. Globally shrinking. And so people are frantic because they don't want to fall into poverty or bad dependence on the government, actually, which is horrible. Then you become a slave. So people are frantic right now. They're frantic. And so they don't have time to look out for anyone else. They really don't. And so this man that almost got hit, he told me, I'm talking with him, and he said, you know what? You can't. No, someone else. It was with me. where I was walking, and he said, "You can't. You've got to trust your gut. You've got to trust your gut now. You can't trust anyone." And that's true. You got to trust the Holy Spirit and your instincts, your intuition. You have to trust your intuition and notice and be mindful, or you're going to get killed in the Bay Area here. It's a terrible place, actually. It would be a grace of God to leave this place, I'll tell you. I don't have the funds to do so. But somehow the grace of God, we'll see. I'm not going to put any expectations on it. In the meantime, have to be very mindful. The way that people drive here is any advantage they can seize. You'd be astonished at what they do. Every day you see things you've never ever seen before in your life in terms of that is a very endangering thing to do. You can't trust the drivers around you anymore. You don't know what they're going to do, which is horrible. Culture runs on trusting one another. And trust has been, you know, destroyed here in the Bay Area. Just destroyed. So, yeah, we get materialism at the cost of trusting one another. You know, what is that? We're going downhill, folks. We are going downhill in the worst possible way. We're losing our motivation. We're losing our trust. It goes on and on and on. And you put your faith then in someone who's potentially a demagogue. I mean, let's be honest. I mean, if the middle class elected Trump for jobs and trust and trying to restore what we used to have. And you got to be careful. Because in such a situation, you might get a demagogue. It's possible, right? It's very possible. It's like a desperate hope. It's like saying, well, here's someone that's strong enough to do it. Maybe, you know, they can be ruthless enough to turn things around. But, you know, the ruthlessness may become the new culture, right? We're not sure. It's already ruthless, to say the least. But turning it around, that also could be a problem. We might be at a point where there's no way to turn it around. And, well, of course, people say, well, look at Germany. Germany is a classic example of this, where the middle class put their faith in Hitler. And initially, he turned it around because the country was in chaos. The socialists had destabilized, the Marxists had destabilized the country. The inflation, the effects of the war, inflation made money worthless, and people were starving, you know, destitute, and there was utter chaos and commotion in the country. And here comes a strong person along who says, look, I will put things right again. And we know what happened. They basically felt we can put the whole world right. The Germans, their recovery was so astonishing that they felt that they had the power to set the entire world right and prevent the chaos from happening again. So they had an altruistic agenda. But it was idealistic, and it wasn't governed through full stop and the wow principles at all. It was still governed through absurdity, okay? Idealism is absurdity, actually. So they're very idealistic, but they were so shocked by their recovery. They were in euphoria, actually, because Germany was absolutely falling apart. And then suddenly, this massive turnaround and euphoria struck, and that's a very dangerous condition. We're not after euphoria. When we see great success, we go into full stop in the wow mode. We don't go into, euphoria mode where you start having the Nuremberg rallies and stuff like that, right? We don't have these massive, that just drums up the enthusiasm and euphoria even more. And then that, we can't handle it. Obviously, we can't handle it. History has proven this. So we don't want to repeat the mistakes of history. So Trump is certainly possible of making a massive turnaround here and bringing about national euphoria, especially among the middle class. Remember, Hitler was brought to power really through the working classes and the middle class people, okay? The SS came from the middle class, brown shirts. It was not the intelligentsia so much. This was a middle class movement. So we have to understand that Trump has the potential to be another Hitler, yeah. Absolutely. Will he be? It depends. But the potential's there if we don't manage it properly. Yeah, we need to turn around. Okay. But it has to be managed carefully. and maybe it won't be. So history may be repeating itself. I mean, people are worried about Trump. Yeah, but also the other alternative was total failure, no question about it. Disastrous failure is just a slow suffocation of the middle class and a polarization of the world into the haves and the have-nots, which is very bad. Again, there's no spiritual destitution worse than being wealthy, okay? But being a slave to the wealthy is also terrible spiritual destitution, okay? You want a middle class, okay? The idea is, the whole purpose of modern age is to develop a very strong middle class that can prevent the wealthy from taking over again. Unfortunately, this didn't happen. It failed. It failed. So Trump is the last hope of the middle class, you know, a strong man, to turn it around. I don't believe he can turn it around. I don't. I believe that the wealthy have a stranglehold on the planet at this point. And there may very well be another war over this. Okay? Materialism, which drives greed, you know, is so empowered at this point. They've gained so much power that if there is a return to power of the middle class, that there may very well be wars, and they may collapse the economy intentionally. I believe that what they'll tell Trump is very simple. He will meet with the Wall Street people and the Federal Reserve and all these people, the power, real powerful people, and they'll tell him very plainly, say, Mr. Trump, let us tell you what the facts of this world really are. And they'll say, look, if you try to push through what you're saying you're going to push through, let us tell you what we're going to do. What we're going to do is we're going to totally collapse the economy, okay? Destroy it, bring chaos to the country, absolute chaos. We'll do it like that. And out of that chaos, we will gain total control of the whole world. So you decide what you want to do, but we're just putting you on notice that we're set to collapse this economy, okay? Now, so they're either going to do, they say, look, we're going to win no matter what you do. We're either going to win, we're either going to have a slow death or a quick death. It's up to you. Either way, we're going to consolidate our power ultimately here. That's what they've already told him that, I'm pretty sure. That's why he's starting to backtrack now. Saying, well, I'm not going to go quite so fast, you know. Yeah. He met the little people on Wall Street, you know. They're not the big, burly, strong men. They're the 5'4" people in these dark suits, you know, to say, Mr. Trump, let us tell you how things really work. You know, you can tell the people you're going to do all these changes, but you better not do them. And this is what the president's run up against. Kennedy ran up against it. There's a shadow government in the world, actually, where the real power is. And they just let the presidents know of all these countries. Says, look, we run things. We control money. We control economy, commerce. We're the ones who control everything. So you do what we tell you to do, or else we're going to bring chaos to your countries, and they'll throw you out anyway. But they can survive the chaos. They know how to. They manage it. So they blackmail him, plain and simple. And they got rid of Kennedy. So there's not a lot of hope going in that direction. However, let us say Trump does do a lot and does restore our national pride, which has been basically destroyed over the last 24 years or so. Starting with Bush 1, then the Clintons, and then Bush 2. That's 8, 8, and 8, right? That's 24 years, Bush, and then the Obama administration. It's been more than that. It's like the last 32 years, our national pride has been just destroyed towards globalism. And we realized that we're just going to be turned into a third world country here, actually. In the United States, I'm talking about. Europe too. Europe's got its severe problems. We all do, right? We all understand it's going to be the extremely wealthy, and the rest of us are just going to be peons, actually. There'll be a service industry, information and service industry. Well, you'll be paid well because you're serving the wealthy, to keeping the slaves in line. But other than that, that's about it, actually. Not a happy scenario, actually. Middle class dream, you know, is being shattered. Being part of the poor middle class myself, a proud part of it, very informed and intelligent part of it, I know it's being destroyed. So the concern is that is not so much over Trump, but over ourselves and our inability to handle euphoria. You cannot handle euphoria. You must avoid that. You must go into full stop. You must allow your success to come step by step. And each step, you must center yourself in full, with no definition. See, we're not going towards definition. We're going towards no definition, because what we are is pure freedom, which has no definition at all. So it's vitally important to take the super positive step of full stop in the wow if you want to avoid getting swept up in the euphoria that could happen. So we have to be ready to avoid the euphoria. It's either going to be a disaster from Trump or euphoria, one or the other. Okay, he's not a middle of the road guy at all. You have to understand. I know Trump. I saw him personally up close for a while. Just him and Johnny Miller at a tea at Pebble Beach. And I was very close. There was hardly anybody else, just a few people around. So he was just natural, was not acting. I mean, he's just completely natural. I watched him play golf, you know, and I saw, this is a while ago, like 10 years ago or something. I saw, this is not a man that does things in half measures, you know. So it's going to be one way or the other with him. Whatever he's going to do, he's going to do it. He's going to do it. All right? You know, when you build those skyscrapers, you do it. You just commit to it and you do it. So, you know, he's not the kind of guy who's going to just schlep us along, you know, in the swamp of despondency. He's either bust or boom, kind of, with him, basically. Bust or boom. That's his personality. And so, either we're going to just go into chaos in terms of just failure of this, failure of that, we don't know what's going on, you know, or we're going to have our national pride restored and we're going to go into euphoria as the United States. And then, you know, the rest of people around the world who think they can tell us what to do, you know, take a big jump somewhere, you know. You don't know our country. I see these people from other countries lecturing us, you know, say Trump does blah, 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 blah. You know, you don't know our country. You don't understand our country. So, you know, butt out of our politics, I would say. You haven't lived here for, you know, 15, 20, 30 generations or whatever. And you don't know the vibe. You don't understand. So it's up to us to manage our politics here and manage our country. And they're all screaming, you know, oh, it's a disaster. They're self-fulfilling prophecy. Self-fulfilling prophecy, you know, on their part. So, what I'm saying is, we're in the danger zone now. And certainly when Trump's inaugurated, we're in the danger zone. Not because Trump's a bad guy or anything, but because we don't know how to handle euphoria. And is it going to either be euphoria or depression? We don't know how to handle either one, as a matter of fact. So we're going into a situation where we're going to be in danger. There's no question about it. He is not a kind of person who accepts failure, okay? Obviously. He seemed to do the impossible by getting elected, which is just astonishing, actually. So it's either going to be a great failure or a great success. And either way, it's either going to be great depression or great euphoria, actually. Because we Americans are so oppressed in our spirit globally, because it's hard to explain. You know, we used to be such a confident country, and feeling in ourselves, the middle class, that we were the hope of the world. And we were actually. And we were designed to be examples for the rest of the world to follow. And I am. I feel myself that I am that way, because I dedicated my life to that. And I've made myself into that. But it was extremely difficult because we've lost our confidence. And the world hates us, and we're apologizing to everyone. You know, we did all this wrong stuff. We're so bad. We're so terrible. You know, and our constitution is being destroyed. You know, and the greatness of this country, which is meant to be a showcase to the rest of the world of how to prevent the takeover of this planet by the super wealthy. You know, they've been attacking it relentlessly. Through the media, the news, the entertainment. That's how the super wealthy, that's all promoted by the super wealthy. Pharmaceutical companies and on and on and on. And they want to destroy America, plain and simple. They want to destroy the middle class. And they are destroying it. So we are being destroyed. And imagine if we get our mojo back, you know, our fire back. Wow, are we going to be euphoric? Just to feel, to walk again and feel confident and say hello to one another, you know? It's astonishing. I mean, we're starting to look at each other and say, hi, how are you? And give each other a hug. Nice to see you today, you know? It's great to see you. We're getting our swagger back. You know, the potential to get our swagger back is here. So, the Holy Spirit has told me, not so fast. Not so fast. There's a danger in that. And they're pointing to Nazi Germany, which I'm, of course, very aware of. I'm a very astute student of history. And I've tried to learn the lessons of history, and I believe the lessons are to be there to be learned. And I believe I understand them. And it's the euphoria that is the danger. The success, too much success, too fast, inability to handle it properly. So I'm come along with full stop and the wow. It's the tool the middle class can use to return to true power and true confidence in themselves. And I have it available here. And I believe Longchenpa is here to help us out. And if we don't use it, there's going to be trouble. You have, however you want to label it, people are very much, really want to be in control of their own path and all this kind of stuff, so they'll label it their own way, which, you know, is a hatred of authority. There's this anti-authoritarian mind trip that's been going on for so long, which in the 60s, there was a place for that. But we overdid it. It's foolish to not get help from authority and respect authority. If the authority is right, it's absurd to be anti-authority. You know, totally absurd. I trust in the authority of the gurus. I absolutely do. They're the authorities. And I love authority. I love right authority. We need it. Otherwise, we go into chaos. Everybody's just doing their own thing. And we've seen what happens. What's happened? The situation we're in right now has happened in the world. That's what's happened. So we need to return, a return to authority, a return to a right authority. That's what the gurus are here for. They're right authority. Okay? They will liberate, help rescue us from absurdity and all that that entails. And so I work for authority. So I'm an authority figure because I work for authority. I represent and extend the authority of the gurus in this world. So I'm saying, you know, I cannot just say, everyone do your own thing. Okay, if they want to, that's fine. But I'm saying here, you have to accept some common labels, or else there's no culture at all, basically. Everybody is off on their own trip, and, you know, you can't communicate with one another. It's very difficult. Very difficult. We're all fragmented, sort of. We went to an old Catholic church yesterday for the memorial service, and wow, walking through there, I just saw thousands of years of history and the tremendous effort everyone made to pitch in and do their part. And it was just, you know, it just took my breath away. Just, oh my gosh, we've thrown all this away. Now, of course, there was a lot of absurdity in what they did. The premise was absurd. Sacrificial atonement is an absurd premise. But they were taking baby steps. But they really did take those baby steps. So now we cannot We don't throw out religion, we fix it. Okay? We don't throw out the divine child. We throw out the dirty bathwater. So there's a lot of dirty bathwater with religion right now. So we throw out the dirty bathwater, but we don't get rid of the premise of religion at all. In fact, we reestablish it stronger than ever. We reestablish it stronger than ever. So that's what I'm about. It has to be done. There's no way we can succeed without a very strong tradition and culture and practice and discipline and trust and authority. We have to restore our trust and authority. Because a continuity fear we have is extremely severe, and it always pushes us towards absurdity. And absurdity then becomes this wild struggle, and we try to dress it up, dress it up in spiritual garb, and that's about all we can do. And it goes very badly for us then. Our mental health deteriorates severely under such situation circumstances, and we don't have the will to even practice full stop on the wow anymore. Most people, they can't even do it. They don't even have the will to do it. That's how bad it is. That's unthinkable in the older days of religious cultures. Everybody had the will to practice, to pray, right? Nobody has even the will to pray anymore. Nobody prayed at the funeral service. Nobody said anything. There was no eulogies. I was just like, no flowers. I said, what is going on here? Now the priest went through, the things and blah, 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 and everyone just did, automatic robotic thing, and that was it, pretty much. I went up to him afterwards and said, hey, the reading you did from St. Paul was profound. It struck me so hard. So he said, look, he said, Jesus died. The reason why Jesus died, St. Paul in Romans 5, I think 7 through 14 or something, said the reason why Jesus died, he came to save, he died to save both the dead and the living. So his death was necessary so he could save both the dead and the living. And I never heard that before so clearly. And I heard it, I said, oh my gosh, that's real Christianity there. Because I understood what Paul was talking about. Paul clearly had some insight into it all. I'm not saying that Paul was perfect by any means, but he clearly had some very profound insight into it all. Because, and I saw in the funeral service, I saw how everyone's so scared of death, right? We're so terrified of it. And we want to be reassured that it'll be okay after we die. And how religion, that's one of our central, the reason why the churches, keep going, because people have funerals there, right? So we pay the priest and the church to have this mass, and it makes everybody feel better because they're scared because their father, their friend, whatever, died, and they say, oh my gosh, I'm gonna die someday, and it scares the heck out of them, and so they want to be told, look, don't worry, he'll be fine, he's being taken care of now, he's in the arms of God, and they say, oh good, thank you, because we don't know, we're scared for ourselves. And we're scared for the dead also. We say, oh my gosh, maybe they're annihilated. We don't know. And if they're annihilated, we will be too. So Jesus came to the world, and everyone saw him. So Jesus, thank you. You're saving us. But what about all those who have died? Are you saving them? And Jesus said, don't worry. I'll go to the kingdom of the dead. And they say, and save them also. To reassure everybody here. Because that's why we're concerned. Because again, if those who've passed on died, if they're not saved, then what hope do we have when we die that we're saved? So they said, Jesus, you got to go save the dead also, those who have already passed on. That was their mindset back then. I understand that. They're very much into that. Throughout history, we've always been very focused on our ancestors, what's happened to them, because that's, we think, that's our future. So they, Jesus said, yeah. Well, he said, well, the only way you can do that is you have to die yourself in order to go into the kingdom of the dead. Now, this isn't true, but for their minds, it was true. So Jesus said, no problem, I'll die for you then, so that you feel comforted and reassured. And then the time that he was dead, he went into the kingdom of the dead, and visited them and witnessed to them. That's what we're told. And then returned here and said, okay, you see, I'm the Lord of both the living and the dead, and I'm coming back to report to you. Like this. And then they were reassured, oh, okay, it's all good then. Because when we die, well, those that have passed on, we feel that they'll be there for us, and because you've gone then to bless them. And so it reassures everybody at a very deep level. So this Christianity has its roots in this reassurance around the issue of death, which is a central issue. It was brought to light yesterday. And you realize everybody there is thinking, you know, that's going to be me someday in that little box of ashes. Right? Unless you do light body ascension, which is certainly we can all do that if we choose to. So they weren't thinking of him so much. They were thinking of themselves. And they try to ward off that fear through materialism, right? Now for me, I've been shown the death-free realm. I can go there. I've shown some paradise, Pure Land realms. I can go there. So I know I've reincarnated many times. And I'm not that concerned, you know. I don't even think about it, really. It's not a big deal. I just sort of am not really focused on dying. Like that's not even an issue for me, really. Never has been. Which is helpful. It's helpful to keep your mind on track, whereas these other people are so scared of dying that they just have to eat, do the, you know, crave. And the man that died, he always said, I'm never going to die, you know. He's trying to be real confident. He said, you're dying, but not me. And he was worried about it, you know. But it got him, too, because of his habits. And, you know, it gets most of us. Not everyone. I mean, there have been a lot of light body ascensions, actually, throughout history, especially in Tibetan Buddhism, actually. When they decide to move on, the breath may stop, the circulation may stop, except the body's in some sort of suspended animation of some sort, and then it just turns into light. And they're aware of it. They said, okay, I'm going to go to the Pure Lands now. I'm going to drop this body, but their consciousness never dies at all. It's completely smooth. They establish their consciousness in the Pure Lands, and then their body, they just turn into light, or it shrinks smaller and smaller and smaller until it just disappears. It's very doable for us. Now, either way, it doesn't, you know, we're not going to make a big deal about it one way or the other. Or you could just stay here, as Jesus said. You can keep the body here as long as you want. No problem. It's no problem at all. As long as you're not trying to make an absurd premise real. if you do that, of course you're going to die. That's the sacrificial Moloch. You're sacrificing these effects to the cause, trying to change the cause through death. In other words, if we have enough things dying to what they are, then we hope the cause will die to what it is. So this whole universe of death is attempt to change the cause. Effects trying to change the cause, or trying to have the cause die to what it is and be something else. And of course Jesus came back and said, look, I haven't changed at all. Death didn't change me at all. I'm exactly the same as before. And they said, what? Really? It's amazing. Nice little rain is coming here. I got everything out of the rain. I had to do a lot of stuff to get stuff out of the rain. Not everything is out of the rain, but a lot of things I had to do. Yeah. So I'm not calling this a silent retreat. I could, but we're retreating towards silence. Silence is really saying everything. It's complete fullness. It's complete wowness. Everything's present. There's no contradiction. And there's no definition. So we're everything. So there's no definition of trying to define ourselves. So words are not even necessary. Silence just means words aren't even necessary for what we are. We're beyond definition. So it's not an absence a poverty state at all. It's just the opposite. It's complete riches. So we're headed towards that. So I may say a few things, but the retreat for most will be a silent retreat, you would say, is less discussion, less talk, less words. Like I said, the discipline is just greet me with a smile, an emoticon or something each day, a heart or emoticon. That's part of the discipline of the retreat. So I put some posts on Facebook on this, and I think there's been like a response. One person's responded a little bit, maybe one day or two, but everyone else ignored it. So I put that up as a feeler to see, you know, what should we do here? We really, if you're going to use Facebook at all, we're going to use it that way. I'm going to post the videos, and if I have any graphics, I will post that too. But I request that everyone who's in the intensive only post like a just blessings or like one word or a little one word or emoticon or something, just saying I'm here, I'm doing the intensive, and for me I'm trying to discipline myself. I mean, each one of us, not for me, but I mean for those who are posting, taking the intensive, less words, less talk, less discussion. That's in the struggle. And, you know, I would like you just to say, wow. I mean, that's the best response out. It is just, wow. That means I'm with you. I'm doing the intensive. Wow. So some of you have been doing this. Some of you are capable of this. There's several I know that are capable of this, if they want to do it. You don't have to do it. But from what I've presented, you can see there's a very good rationale behind it. I'm starting to, once that I committed to it, then the rationale, the Dharma Kings explained it to me. Interesting. This is this problem with euphoria. It's either be depression or euphoria. One of the two is going to be coming in the world. Especially if you're in the United States, but globally too. It is, you know, you're going to be in for a shock. One way or the other, globally. There's no question about it, right? You know this. You know it. You have to handle your euphoria, your success properly. That is the most dangerous thing there is success. Which is why we keep staying in failure. We keep saying, failure's safer. But is it? Or does it make the recovery from failure even more difficult? Which makes then desire for even more failure. So it's a negative spiral we were on. We've been on this negative spiral for quite some time. So the United States decided enough's enough. We're going to go back. We're going to try to put it on a positive footing again. But there's this very real and present danger of this. Big time. And so we don't need the rest of the world to lecture us. What we need is the rest of the world to take this intensive. You know, so enough of this posturing. There's a lot of people who can talk big. But who has the will to take the intensive? It's all about will. If you don't have the will to do it, then you're just a pretender, a poser. You know, that's all you are. That is true. So at some point, you know, you got to back up the talk. You have to walk the walk. And the time has come for that. I've been saying for years, the time will come when you have to walk the walk as well. So you better start doing it. And we now have arrived at that time, starting November 21st, 2016. We will have to walk the walk. Start walking the walk. And so I'm giving all these tools to help you out. All right? You can go to YouTube, watch the videos, and comment, you know, say or like it, and say, wow. Wow. And, you know, in some way, there has to be some accountability at some point, right? I mean, I have no accountability. No one's had any accountability. I don't know who's watching the videos and whether they like them or anything. If you watch the video, you just say, wow. In other words, I've watched it. I watched it. That's part of the intensive. How can we be in the presence of a guru if we have no practice with accountability whatsoever? I mean, well, people are just dreaming. What are they thinking? The guru is going to say, I want you to do this. In other words, you have to be accountable. Say, I can do this. So if you if you have no accountability, oh, you practice zero accountability, you're really good at, well, nobody knows whether I'm doing it or not. Well, the guru knows. You can't hide from the guru. All these people think that they're doing things secretly and hiding. You can't hide anything from the guru. So that's why the Longchenpa came to me, because he saw I was actually doing it. I actually was using my will. There's no secrets. He could see it plainly. So those who think they're getting away with being lazy, you're not getting away with it with the guru at all. You're not getting away with it. They know. They know who's lazy and who's been applying themselves. I've been applying myself. So that's known to the gurus. So I'm put in a position of responsible authority. Rightfully so. Because I hold myself accountable to actually doing it. So when I say to Longchenpa, I'll do the intensive, he knows I'm going to do it. There's no doubt about it. So the Ed trusted me. He says, I don't have to worry about Clary Ross. He's going to do it for sure. I can trust in him. I can rely upon him. The gurus are looking for those that they can rely upon. Of course, right? If you're helping reestablish the Dharma and the motivation, spiritual motivation in the world, which must be done, you're going to ask those that you can rely upon to help you out. Of course, if you're going to establish a business and you want it to be a thriving business, you're going to look for managers and stuff that you can trust, you can rely and trust upon. You think Apple Incorporated, they just grabs anyone off the street and say, here, we'll put you in a real responsible position because, we'll give you a chance. No, they're going to, you assemble a team together, you say, look, you've been doing it for 20 years, 30 years, you've had super success, we're going to put you in this position because we know we can rely upon you. You're going to push it through, no question. So how in the world do we think that we're going to establish the true business of this world, which is reestablish spiritual motivation on this planet, and not have reliable people doing this? That is just an absolute absurdity. Okay. Again, absurdity tries to dictate to us, you know, what we're supposed to do. No, you're going to get the most reliable people helping you out. But absurdity thinks it knows better. It doesn't know anything. It's just hoping if we remain absurd long enough, we can change the premise, change the causation. It's just a vain hope. All absurdity is a completely vain hope. It's nothing else. There's no intelligence to absurdity at all, actually. We've thrown a bunch of logical consistency, but none of the logic holds water. It's like a cup that's, you know, no bottom to the cup. We keep pouring stuff in. We think, well, we're real smart. We're real smart. We're filling our cup. But it never fills. It never fills. You look and it's empty. If you look, those who follow absurdity, you look in their cup, there's nothing there. There's no real intelligence there at all, actually. There's calculation and cleverness, but no real wisdom at all. Empty cups. They're just waiting for the change to happen, which will never happen. So Longchenpa says, okay, Clarity Ross, I know you will do it. It's a done deal. When you say you'll do it, it's already a done deal. So we're going to do it. Let's get it going. So at some point, you have to start practicing accountability for your own sake. For your own sake. I don't care who does it or who doesn't do it, but for your own sake, you have to have some guidelines to bring you towards success. Ultimately, the more accountable you are and responsible are, you'll have more contact with the guru, and they'll start giving you responsibility, and you'll start helping them. That's how it works here. That's how it's always worked. What are we thinking of? There's been many gurus come to this world, and they've called their top managers, etc., in and say, hey, will you help me? And they say, yeah. And so they've established then spiritual motivation on the planet through that way. So if you want to be part of that management team, you have to start showing accountability. There's no question about it. How can I, for instance, trust in those? I have no idea if they're being accountable at all. I don't have any idea, really, who watches my videos or not. Not really. There's a few, I mean, because there's no comments and there's no likes. You know, nobody says anything. And on Facebook, you know, so I don't know who looks at what I post on there or not. There's maybe a couple likes, but maybe 100 people have looked and not said anything. So, you know, again, they're trying to have it both ways. They have the foot in both absurdity and non-absurdity, which is what? That is absurdity. Okay. When you have one foot on the train and one foot on the platform, guess what? You're not going anywhere. You think you're going somewhere. You're not going anywhere. When the train pulls out of the station, you don't have a position of going somewhere. You're going to get torn in half. You know, you're going to fall off the platform. That's no position at all. Jesus said you can't serve two masters. You cannot serve absurdity and non-absurdity at the same time. Absurdity says you can. That's absurdity. So if we're trying to serve both, we are serving absurdity. Plain it, 100%. 100%. So somehow I have to, you know, coax people towards some more accountability. I mean, it's not my nature to tell anybody what to do, really, because I'm very free myself. However, in this circumstance that we're heading towards, it's a wise move to start holding yourself accountable. Now, you might say, well, I might get in trouble with people. You're already in psychological trouble. The trouble is psychological. It's how do you get out of the trouble you're already in? That's the question. And now that we have Trump as the president of the United States, the idea of we're going to get in severe trouble is a little bit less at this point, I would say. Ultimately, it could play out that way. But again, everyone's going to be in trouble if that's the case. So, you know, at some point, you have to trust the gurus that they have your back. If you don't trust them to protect you from trouble, then I don't know, you know, what you're doing even believing in them in the first place. They're bound Dharma protection, Dharma mercy, Dharma responsibility, Dharma mercy, Dharma protection. They're bound to help us out. They're bound by that. We commit to them, then they have a relationship. Just like a parent is committed to protecting the child, you know? What kind of parent offers no protection to a child, you know, from the wolves, you know, or the good shepherd, the sheep from the wolves? Of course Jesus is bound to protect us. Dharma kings are bound to protect those who work for them. Now, we can throw that protection away if we want, but we don't have to. They don't tell us to. We don't have to go back to absurdity and say, I need to sacrifice myself to try to make absurdity work, to reach its goal. Yeah, because the world says, look, if you just help absurdity while you're death, then that'll be a significant death to us, and it'll help us reach our goal, because that proves that'll help us, you know, be loyal to the goal of absurdity, which will transform the causation of it. No, that doesn't work at all. It doesn't work at all. They said, Jesus, surely your death will change. He says, no. He said, but you're so powerful. Jesus said, I'm not more powerful than God. I cannot change God at all. Jesus came to tell us, I cannot change God at all. Even I cannot change God at all. And apparently, everybody said, no, you are God. And so your death means you did change God, and our plan of absurdity worked. You know, they start cheering like that. Jesus said, no. So immediately they tried to cheer an absurdist goal. What could you do, right, Jesus? Got the ball rolling, but we have to keep it rolling here. So, fix religion, don't throw out religion, don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. Now, it may need to be a big fix. I mean, Catholicism can't be fixed. It cannot. I've studied it at great depth. There's no way to fix it. All the premises are absurdist. And they're so used to that, you know, it's just, it's not fixable. I don't know how fixable Buddhism is, actually, at this point. It's deteriorated very badly. So, we keep the goal. The baby is the goal. We keep that, and then clean the bathwater. Clean bathwater, and like that, we go forward in that way. We fix it. And of course it's fixable. We're fixing it right here, right now. So, somehow, you know, I'm going to have to hold people accountable and say, you know, for the 6-2 months, then, you know, I'm going to have to say, Subway, if you wow the videos, it means you've watched them, then I'll give you another one. If you don't watch what I'm giving, you know, then I'm not going to give out others, something like that. There has to be some motivation, incentive, because we're dying because of lack of motivation and incentive. So at some point, you got to stand up to absurdity and say, look, absurdity, say, oh, well, I don't need to do that. I have my own authority, blah, you know. Yeah, at some point, say, no. I'm trying to get close to the true authority, the guru. So I have to accept some authority. What are we going to do? Meet the guru and say, oh, you have no authority over me. I mean, what? Yeah, freedom, we're talking freedom. Well, no, we're talking pragmatism here. Freedom comes from taking the right pragmatic steps. Continuity fear will give you a return ticket to this world if you're not very, very, use your will, very willful and adamant in taking the right steps. And you will not abide in paradise. You will leave it if you're not properly prepared. So let us not try to pull rank on the gurus here. You know, what they say goes. Without being too heavy-handed about it, right? But we're just saying the minimum. I mean, we're just talking about the bare minimum of accountability. We're not being heavy-handed. And maybe people are so desperate for authoritarianism that they're afraid to even take the first step because they think that they'll become slaves, you know. But you know, here we demand freedom for the most part of everyone, right? But a little bit of accountability in some way. So I don't know how I'll set it up, but there must be some way, right? There's a lot of videos. I've been putting out, my eyesight's going bad. I got to stop doing so many because I can't hardly see anymore because my eyes get tired and strained. But in one way or another, you know me, I manage somehow to throw up videos, right? Almost on a virtually daily basis. For years, every single day, I've proven I can do it, and I've done it. So, you know, it's not likely that I'm just going to halt. You know, it could happen, but, and I have a lot of graphics, of course, I can throw those up. But, so I don't know how I'll be able to manage it, but I will do my best to in some way. Because if you prove your accountability and really do it, you know, then down the line, I can see that you're reliable, and I'll be, you know, giving out more help, and maybe you will be able to get into more sublime stuff where others would not be able to. Maybe the videos will be private, and I'll tell you, say, hey, I have this video for you. I don't know exactly how that can work. I have to, on YouTube, I think you have to have an account, a YouTube account, and then I put your username somewhere so that you can access private videos. I might even do that for some people. I'll look into that. And maybe with even this intensive, I might even do that. That is possible. In fact, if I can figure out how to do that, because I know there are a few of you that will watch the videos. And maybe it's time right now to start instituting this and not making it available to everybody, actually. Because I see that there's a big problem with that. So I'm going to look into this. Anyone can make a YouTube account, of course. I don't know how to make the videos on, like, Facebook invitation only kind of thing. There might be a way to do that. Only friends can view this video. There's probably a way to do that on Facebook as well, right? So I will look into that too. And I may go that direction, actually. And I may clean up my timeline. I actually started cleaning up my timeline yesterday. And I started, you know, unfollowing various people who were posting stuff that was off target. You know, all these animal videos and various things like that. It's just stuff that's not aligned, you know. I cleaned up my timeline and it's way better now. I said, wow, that's way better. But I can't have a whole bunch of intrusions on the timeline, my timeline necessary. I don't know how I'm going to work on that. But we're going to, for 2 months, we're going to really focus in here. So extraneous stuff is going to have to be blocked in some way. That's what a retreat, an intensive is all about, is you cut out the extraneous stuff for a while. And, you know, like television, one of the greatest practices you can possibly do is cut out television for a year. I've done that twice already in my life. Banned television for an entire year. None. Zero. I've banned radio now for almost 2 years. No radio. Okay, now, when you go back to it, you will be astonished at what you see. It's one of the greatest practices there is in the Holy Spirit. I've done it. See, I'm someone who's already done all these intensives like this. I've done it. So I know it can be done. I know the effectiveness of it. And when you see television, I saw one game of the World Series, just part of it, and I said, oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. That's enough of that. Okay, you're finished, television. You see how horrible it really is. And you just say, oh, thank God I'm not watching it. Thank God I have a habit of not watching it. And it's very precious. You realize you have a very precious habit there. But the only way you're going to get that is to do it. And then hindsight, you'll see and say, oh my gosh, that was such a valuable thing I did. So valuable. And interestingly enough, I've come across some people who've done that. I've come across a friend, and I asked him about sports, and he says, well, I'm not following it anymore. I said, what? You're a huge follower. He says, yeah, but I cut my cable. I cut the cable. What? He said, yeah, I cut it a year ago. When? In August. I said, that's the same time I did. That's amazing. He said, yeah, I haven't watched any television over a year. I said, I haven't either. I said, why'd you stop? He said, I couldn't take it anymore. It was, you know, I said, same with me. I reached a point, I said, that's it. I realized it's so horrible now, I can't subject myself to that. I've had enough. And he said, yeah, that's it. I've come across a number of people like this, actually. We just spontaneously realized, I'm not going to go down, I'm not going to sink into absurdity, which is what television is, the siren song of absurdity. Okay, TV and movies and entertainment, mostly it comes through television and our smartphones. It's the siren song of absurdity singing sweetly in our ear, okay? That's what it is. And say, don't worry, as you suffer hideously waiting for absurdity to become the new God, we have all these pharmaceutical drugs you can use to calm you down. And when you get sick and die, we'll just pump you full of morphine and you'll have sweet dreams. Don't worry, right? And when you get an illness, we'll help you assisted suicide. Don't worry. Okay. It's a siren song of absurdity that's being sung. Guaranteed. You want to stay away from the siren song at all costs. Those who don't come complaining. You know, well, you will anyway. But, you know, you get what you deserve. Basically, you'll get what you aim for, which is loyalty to absurdity. And the hideous misery that and mental illness that comes along with that. You know, don't say I didn't warn you, because I spent a lifetime, all I've done is warn people, and they don't listen, because they keep thinking they're smarter than me. Because, oh yeah, he's smart, but I'm smarter. That's the way I've been treated in my life. Oh yeah, he is a real smart guy, but actually I'm a little bit smarter. I see a better way. You know, I'm going to wait. Absurdity's going to win. Yeah. I'm telling them, no, absurdity is not going to win. No, we'll make it win. Our death will make it win. We'll all die and that'll make it. No, it doesn't. You just return here. You don't die at all, really. Nothing dies. You know, we'll wait long enough. Well, the time doesn't exist. You're just waiting in nothing. Now, we'll make it happen. Nothing's going to happen. Nothing has ever happened. So, I mean, what precedent do you have to say we'll make it happen? You haven't done anything. So, I mean, where's your confidence? Is nothing but bluster. And they say, well, they're smarter than me. I'm based on what? Based on just pure bluster? That's all it's based on. So, I may make the videos private. That is possible. And then I put a list of 30 people or whatever. I don't know if more than 30 will take it. That's about the number of people who watch the videos anyway. Your name will be on that list, and then I think I have to invite you or something to watch the video. That's a lot of work for me. If it's unlisted, I give you a link to it. But how would I, you know, do that? I could do it in Facebook messaging and send you a link. That's a lot of work for me, for sure. But I may I may take this step. I'm considering it. You know, if it's doable, I may do it. Because right now people are getting really weird. Okay, they're getting really weird. I'm getting some weird comments on my videos from those psychotics actually, that are basically saying, "Look, I can't handle this. I cannot handle this." So I'm realize, hey, you know, it may be a sign that to make the videos private at this point. And again, 30 or whatever, 30 viewers is good. I'll check into it now. 30 people taking an intensive, that's extraordinary. Now maybe there won't be that many, but maybe there will. I don't know. I think at some point, if we don't realize the trouble we're in right now, and I have a better grasp of the trouble than most, maybe than anyone, because I'm pointing out it's really the trouble is with our success. You know, everyone's thinking Trump's a disaster. No, the trouble is, what if he succeeds? We can't handle success as a nation right now. We don't know how to handle it. We really don't. We really don't know how to handle it. Like the 60s, I mean, they broke the establishment. I mean, they really did. We were so successful, we didn't know how to handle it. We went into sex, drugs, and rock and roll, you know? And many of us died. Many of us had mental breakdowns. Nobody really succeeded very well out of that situation. They didn't know how to manage it. Some better than others. But, you know, it was a disaster in many ways, and which set the scene for this, you know, the collapse into Marxism, social Marxism, and the collapse of spiritual motivation on the planet. We were more successful than we could possibly have imagined. Really, it was astonishing. It was astonishing what we did in the 60s. Now, I don't take much credit for it. It was the baby boomers, you know, who really did it. And I'm, you know, just past the baby boomers, born in 1956. Baby boomers are like, I don't know, 45 to 55, that kind of thing. That 10-year span, so I'm 56. So I'm technically not a boomer. Right on the edge of it, but not quite in it. So they were wildly successful, and they didn't handle their success well, to say the least. They botched it. They botched it, okay? So boomers, you botched it, okay? I can stand up to you and tell you this fact. It's a fact. You didn't handle your success properly. You thought that success was all there was to it. No. Managing your success is the harder part of success. It's the harder part. And you were lazy and you didn't do that. And you've created this massive trouble now. I mean, a lot of young generations realize the boomers created this massive trouble. They did. Because they didn't handle the success properly. And yet the younger generation, those who criticize them, younger generation, they don't have a clue what to do. They think they do, but do they know how to manage their success? No, they don't. Clueless. Same old problem throughout history. And so I know how to manage my success. Full stop in the wow is how, for all of us, how to manage our success. It's the same principle for all of us. We cannot fall into defining our success. We must not, because our success is spiritual success. And what we are is we're pure freedom, which obviously can never be defined in any way, actually. Otherwise, it's not pure freedom, right? So we are created as pure freedom. That's what we are. That's what God is. We can't change that in any way. So we must, the success that we have must be put into the right context. Otherwise, you're setting the seeds for future disaster, which we're in right now. So we decided once again, let us try again with Trump, other than just embrace doom with Clinton. And again, we run the risk of botching our success. And I don't see anybody, really, hardly anyone, waking up to this issue. I'm seeming to be the only lone voice in the world that I've seen adamantly defining what the issue really is, which is managing our success properly, our fantastic success. I mean, breaking free of absurdity is such extraordinary success. You have to manage it. That's the harder part. Getting the insights is the easy part. Managing your success is the more difficult part. And nobody has talked about this. They refuse to talk about it. It's ridiculous. It's absurd. It means absurdity. They're still in the grip of absurdity, because absurdity knows if you don't manage your success, you're going right back into the arms of absurdity for sure. So it says, yeah, sure, non-dual, 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 Ramana, you know, Rumi, Nandamayama, all the, you know, the stuff. Sure, that's fine. As long as you don't manage your success. The ego says, sure. Absurdity says, sure, you can get into all that stuff, no problem. Because it knows it's failed before, it'll fail again. I mean, we're all into that in the 60s, right? Look what happened. We're in the fangs of a technocracy, a Marxist, social Marxist technocracy, with the motivation of true spiritual approach virtually collapsed, going towards an atheistic society. That's the result of the 60s, folks. It's horrible. And so the absurdity knows, oh, that's no problem. All this spirituality we have now, with no focus on how to manage our success at all, is guaranteed to drive us into the arms of a future despotic technocracy. And you will regret that to the ultimate extent. So all this stuff on Facebook, you know, there's nothing that focuses on managing success. And I'm an expert in this. This is my whole focus. And so I can tell. You know, you can't pull the wool over my eyes. If you're a virtuoso pianist, and somebody comes up with full bluster, I'm great too, man. So, okay, well, let's sit down, let's hear you play. And, well, you know, I can't play. Well, I'm not feeling so great today. I got kind of arthritis in my fingers. I feel bad. You know, excuse. They might play a little bit and say, hey, you know, see? I said, what do you mean? That was nothing. I mean, let me hear you really do. Let me hear the virtuosity. Let me hear you just shift from one key to the next. Let me just hear you play spontaneously. I'm going to call out different tunes, different stuff I want you to play. You should be able to just to smoothly segue into anything. What are you talking about? You know, no, they can't do it at all. They can't do it at all. So I'm concerned because there's a lack of focus on this. So I'm not going to be dragged down into it. So I have to go into some retreat, intensive retreat myself. And I got to start managing my success and keep the focus on managing our success. It doesn't exist on Facebook. It doesn't exist on YouTube. It doesn't exist anywhere that I'm aware of. And again, those who might just retroactively, you know, say, oh, gee, if I say that I do it, I can do it, maybe you'll accept it. No. I see no evidence of it. I see no evidence of that. Where's the evidence? Most people are too lazy. They won't do it. They put all their effort into some sort of, you know, they want to be some guru or something, but, you know, you don't get to be a guru until you know how to manage your success expertly. So they just then fall back on graphics and quotes. Graphics and quotes aren't going to get it done for you. We did that in the 60s, okay? This is just the 60s all over again. It's the 60s on Facebook. We botched it then, and I see every evidence we're going to botch it again. And I'm not going to be part of that. No way. I said, why did I fail in the 60s? I fell into mental illness, depression, couldn't sleep, despair, everything. Everything. Because nobody taught us how to manage our success. And we threw out the baby with the bathwater. We threw out all tradition, all authority, gone. And we had no clue. And we floundered. Some floundered. And others took refuge in immateriality. And now they're the new wealthy elites. I mean, so many boomers are so fabulously wealthy right now, and they spend their time gallivanting and buying toys. They're so wealthy, okay? They're so wealthy. How many homes do they have, you know? Are you kidding me? Those are the boomers. And other boomers, they're destitute. They either died or destitute or drug addicts or, you know, I mean, they're, you know, they mental illness or stuff, heavy on medications and things. They don't know how to handle their success. We botched it, folks. So I'm not going to botch it again. I'm thinking, I realize that the same thing is happening again. History's repeating itself. So I'm thinking, how can I not fail again? And I'm not going to fail again. Once is enough. So it's full stop in the wow that is will prevent my failure. No question about it. Managing my spiritual success is paramount, not activism, folks. This is the trap. All these activist people are trying to hit me on Facebook. You know, this and this. That's the 60s. Hey, I've been through the 60s. I'm nobody's fool. Okay? I know all of this backwards and forwards now. And what that does, it makes you feel euphoric. Yeah, we're winning. But none of them have a clue of how to manage their success. And none, you have to do it for yourself. You don't pull in some guru who fixes the problem for you. The guru motivates you to do your own sadhana, your own spiritual practice. That's the guru. I mean, these people think there's some gold digger, you know, I mean, not a gold, what do you call it? Sugar daddy. Some sugar daddy guru is going to come along and say, oh yeah, don't worry, I'll fix it. I'll fix your success for you. No, those become the lunatic gurus who enslave you to them. It turns into a cult. Because they'll manage success for you, don't worry. No. The real guru says, I will train you how to manage your success. Otherwise, no. You're not fit for the path. You're not fit for it. You think these Tibetan lamas pull somebody in who's not fit for the path, and they say, "No, you'll handle all the success for me. I don't have to do anything." That are you kidding? They're saying, "You know, do this meditation, do this thing, do this." They tell you what to do, but you have to do it. They'll offer suggestions towards this would be a good idea to do. It's like Longchenpa said, saying, this is a good idea to take this two-month retreat, intensive. But I have to do it. He's suggesting it. He can't do it for me. That's absurd. We're all sovereign free. We have to accept our own freedom. Nobody can be free for us. We can't be bound and be happy. Well, someone else is free, but I'm enslaved by fear that, no, that's okay, I'm happy. No. We have to function in reality with our freedom. All of us have to. We're all equal. Absurdity has made idiots out of us, you know, in terms of, wow, it's astonishing, isn't it? So how do we survive 60s part two? I know how. So I'm saying, folks, this is how we survive 60s part two. Don't make the same mistakes you made before. And don't just go down the tubes with your medications and, oh, well, I can't do it. You know, don't just completely disengage from your life, right? That's failure also. Now, be on fire. I'm on fire. I'm proactive. I'm doing stuff. I'm very activist in spiritual way of managing our success. I'm super activist. So I have a super activist program, which is to avoid the mistakes of history, which people are stepping right in it again. What brought about the 60s? John F. Kennedy brought about the 60s. Okay, Trump's very much like John F. Kennedy in many ways. He's super confident in himself. He's super capable. He attracts super confident and capable people to him. Their can-do attitude. We can do this. Okay, that was the 60s. The 60s happened because John F. Kennedy happened. And he said, citizens, we are going to get this done. We are going to make this Camelot. We are going to make this shining city on a hill. And there's no doubt in my mind that we're going to do it. And let's go do it. And people were just fired up like you can't believe. Because he was a populist, and he was a Catholic, and he had some values. He had real values, John F. Kennedy, actually. Now, he had some vices as well, as we know. But you take the good with the bad with political leaders, right? They're not gurus. But he had some values, he had some principles, and he stuck to them. And you know, he was in World War II. I mean, he was disciplined, and he was bright. And he says, we have some principles, and we're going to establish these principles. And we're not going to let the military-industrial establishment tell us what to do. We're not going to let anyone tell us what to do. We're going to do it ourselves. So he empowered the people, said, we're going to do it. And we're going to export America to the world and say, look, these are the principles that we have that can help everybody. So he fired up the whole country. And then the 60s happened with activism in every direction. Activism wherever you look. Activism, activism, activism. Taken on the establishment. Taken on the military. Taken on the corporations. Taken on this. Taken on that. Taken on injustice. Taken on, you know, civil rights. Taken on this. Taken on that. And we changed the whole, we flipped the whole script. The boomers flipped the whole script. I didn't really flip it. I was into my spiritual discipline already from the day I was born. Saying, hey folks, you know, you may flip the script, but you got to manage your success. And they didn't. They didn't listen to me. Who are you? Little brother. You know, they didn't listen to me. So, you know, now that's caused severe problems. They didn't listen to the gurus. They didn't really listen to them. They were so confident, they said, we can even tell the gurus what to do. So, yeah, Mr. and Mrs. Guru, nice to meet you, you know. So, how can we help you? You know, so, well, we see some things that we'd like to change, you know, and let's kind of change our ashram structure around here. You know, we're the Peace Corps people, you know. They're like, we're going to go tell the rest of the world, you know, the way to live. Well, that's fine for some of the world, but it's not fine for the gurus. You don't go and tell the gurus how to run their business. So, Americans got a little overconfident, you know, which is a problem, because they didn't know how to manage their success. And then backlash, is, you know, people started hating Americans because, but we used to have very good principles and morals. And, but we didn't know how to manage our success. So, here we go. We're back in the 60s, are reoccurring. We have this charismatic, can-do president of the United States who's going to tell the rest of the world, hey, this is how we're going to do it. You're not going to tell us what to do. We're going to tell you what to do. If you want to, you know, well, you could do whatever you want to do, but we're going to do what we want to do, okay? You're not going to dictate to us anymore. And he's going to tell the people, you know what? You can make a difference. We can change the wrongs that are happening in this world. And there's a lot of wrongs in the United States right now. And they got to be stopped. That is true. However, the risk we run is we don't know how to manage our success, and it's going to go real bad at some point down the road. So I'm sure the gurus know this. Longchenpa knows that. He knows there's a big crisis coming, and this is why he contacted me 3 years ago and said, would you like to help? Actually, it was like 6 years ago. He said, would you like to help me? At that point, I had no idea, like, what was he talking about? I mean, the way he talked was like over my head, you know? His mind was over my head. I couldn't handle it. So I said, I don't know. I got to get up to speed. I said, if I get up to speed, I'll reconsider. So I said, okay. We left it at that. I was offered a position. Some Longchenpa offered me a position like 6 years ago. He said, would you like to work for me? And work with me, really. Work for me and with me. And I said, well, I don't know who you are. I can tell you're extraordinarily profound, but I don't really understand what the heck you're saying, and you're, you know, you're the way you are. It's like I can't quite relate to it yet. And I said, I'll try. I said, let me see if I can get up to speed. So I spent like 3 years getting up to speed, and then he contacted me again and said, I'm here. So I said, wow, that's great. Okay, so now I need to get up to speed again to the fact that I am working for you. Before, I was considering the request, and then I guess I agreed to the request. Said, okay, I said, whoever shows up, I'll work with you. He showed up, which means I promised I'd work with whoever showed up, and he's the one that showed up. So I'm working with him. So I spent 3 more years getting up to speed. So I don't allow the Tibetan Buddhists to push me around and bully me in any way. I mean, I do what Longchenpa tells me to do. I don't do what Tibetan Buddhists tell me what to do. They're not the gurus. Longchenpa's the guru, my guru. So I had to get up to speed because the Tibetan Buddhists are quite confident themselves in their various traditions and various stuff, and they feel like they can very pretty much, you know, if you're someone spiritually, say, well, we'll tell you what to do. Well, excuse me, Longchenpa tells me what to do. The Dharma King tells me to do. I work directly with him, directly. And he is not bound by any form of Tibetan Buddhism, okay? He's bound by what works. And he knows what's best. He has a full understanding of the whole situation. Not some, you know, Tibetan Lama or something that I see them and they're very confident, but their presence is not there. The presence is not there. It's there more in the Dzogchen masters. But a lot of the regular Tibetan Buddhists at this point, they're very skilled in debate. They've had a monastic education and stuff, and they know the various forms and traditions, and some of them have loving kindness, and they're kind and compassionate, and there's a lot of, they've got a lot of good stuff going on, but they're not Nyingma masters. So they don't have any authority over me. And we're not even equal authority. I have greater authority. I work directly with a great Nyingma master, Dzogchen master, an omniscient Dharma king. So that's a higher authority than someone who's had some monastic education or something. But, they may not see it that way. That's the problem in all religions, that they get a little religion and you start getting some confidence. That's good. I'm all about confidence. But you got to manage your confidence. I'm an expert in managing confidence and managing success. So you need more success. You're not there yet. You're not there by any stretch of the imagination. Abiding in pure Rigpa, pure conscious, are you there yet? I don't think so, right? You're not there yet. Well, let's be humble and say we may not get there this life. So let's be humble, Let's be humble let's be very confident but also humble and realize that continuity fear is a very severe problem. I don't care who you are. Even the gurus recognize this. They're strict with their practicing too, aren't they? They're setting the example. They're saying, I may be free, but I want to set the example. Don't get overconfident. Stay super confident, but also humble about it. You meet someone, you stay humble. You don't know who they are. They may be showing you something that's very important. I don't care who it is. I don't care who it is. Yeah, I try to stay humble with everybody. Whoever I meet, they may have some very important, some message for me in some way, something I need to pay attention to. So I don't big time them. But if you're in a retreat or intensive, somebody has to be running that, okay? It can't be chaos. So I have to take responsibility for that. But in terms of overallness, I'm not trying to big time anyone. I have to stay humble. Because I still have continuity fear. Of course I do. We all do. We all do. And it's a severe habit. It's the most dangerous habit there is. It's all there is, actually. It's all bad habits lumped into one, which is what familiarity with those bad habits, the issue of familiarity, and going back into those bad habits again. So we're getting there, aren't we? Yeah. This is another great, 2.5 hour intensive video, right? Was able to do it, of course. I gotta rest my voice a little. I've been vocalizing 5 days a week, all day long, and the voice starts to get tired. You gotta give little breaks to it. You cannot do that every single day. Of course, you're gonna wear things out. You have to recover from that. So, I probably need to watch that. I did a whole week of intense vocalization. Wow, it was amazing, amazing. Just flights of the butterfly, the hummingbird. I'm the hummingbird. I'm the vocal hummingbird. I can just go in any direction at any time. It's fun to be like a hummingbird, isn't it? I'm a vocal hummingbird. But I don't do it. I don't do it for anyone, I don't do it as a performance for anyone. Because that makes it a commodity, I refuse to make my art a commodity. Art has to, be free, otherwise you'll get trapped into materialism, into making it a commodity. It's a performance, a commodity. And then you start building expectations up in people, and you get trapped by those expectations. Don't do performances. Don't perform. And if there's a, I don't know if I'll do anything or not. Possible. I mean, is potential. If I do any music, it'll have to be private for only those who are taking the intensive. And I've been thinking about how to do music videos. It's on my mind. And I realize there is a way to do it, actually. There is a way to do it. There's a lot of work editing and stuff. I can make it simple, or I can edit more complex. So this has actually been the last couple of weeks I've been starting to figure out how I could actually do music videos. But the problem is I don't want to make them public. It's not a performance. It's not a performance. Just like I say, all high art, sublime art, should be always only available to those who commit to the Dharma, who are committed to intensives, retreats, etc. Others should have no right to it. They have no right to it, because the whole purpose is to attract you to freedom from definition. It is not to be turned into a commodity. It is not to be turned into a performance. Never. That's taboo. And I understand that very clearly now, why this is so. The sublime should only be used to attract you to your freedom, to the sublime. And you are the sublime. It never should be for the purpose of profit or turning into a commodity and generating profits for the greedy. You know, and so much art has been exploited by the greedy, have they not? The managers, the promoters, all these people who have no true creativity of their own, make money off the artists, turn it into a commodity, and then sell it to everybody and make massive fortunes from it. That's the entertainment industry. It's vile, the entertainment industry. So for me, my expression is too sublime to be turned into a commodity or a performance. So those greedy people are out of luck. Greedy mindset, fear-based mindset, absurdity mindset. Of course, everybody wants drugs to keep them in absurdity so they can, hopefully it'll finally work for us, you know. No, it'll never work for us. And then everyone drugs themselves. Music can be a drug if you use it in the wrong way. Or it can be in a sublime experience, which has to attract you to managing your success. If you don't, so I'm saying, look, if you're committed to full stop in the wild practice, you should have access to stuff that others don't. I mean, isn't that only fair? Isn't that only right and just and actually spiritually correct? So we need to practice spiritual correctness here. If you're committed, you have the right. Why should somebody who wants to turn into a commodity and has no commitment to the path, to the Dharma, why should they have the same access to something sublime as you? I mean, why? Is that fair? I mean, is that right? Is that make any reason at all? No, it doesn't, actually. It doesn't. So I've been putting all my stuff out for everybody, but maybe the problem is I need to now change that. Because I'm capable of shifting into this even more sublime stuff. I'm showcasing, you know, I'm capable of it, believe me, if I decide to do it. I could sing, you know, I can vocalize to very extraordinary way. And I can put together some very sublime videos, as you are starting to see now. But this has to be the province of those who are committed to managing their success, which we call our calling. We're going to call it. We need to have some common nomenclature, or it gets confusing. Full stop in the wow practice. Full stop in the wow commitment. Which means I'm managing my success. Now, what your success is and how, that's the, you know, that's, you're more free in that. You're free in that. I mean, what's your success? How you get to it, etc. But there's the common denominator is managing that success. And so we have to be on the same page with that. How do I manage my success? It's, you don't define it. You're committed to not defining it. And there's a way of practicing that, that I'm very, very clearly aware of it. And I've been doing it for a long time. So I can make videos available to those who are committed to this full stop in the wild intensive. We can start out by doing that. And maybe I'll start, I've actually started with Jimmy, I actually started giving, you know, some videos that weren't available to everyone. And then later on I made them available to everyone. And I think Kaylin also with you and Greg also. And you know, a little bit of previewing, various people getting sneak previews of the videos. But what I'll do is, I'll start putting out full videos that are just, you know, unlisted. unlisted, and I'll message you in some way. Those who commit to this intensive, I don't know who will commit. Maybe nobody. In which case, maybe no videos. None of these sublime videos. I may still tape like this type of video for everybody. So there'll be two levels of videos. There'll be ones that are for everybody inviting you to this intensive, and then those who commit to the intensive, they'll have unlisted videos, which I'll give you the links to them on Facebook Messenger, that you can watch those. You can watch those. But as far as sharing it with someone else, that's a question, isn't it? You may not want to do that. It may be getting you into trouble. In which case, I could go private video, and if you're not on the list, you can't share it with anyone either. So what you should share, if you want to share, I have a level of stuff that you can share with others, which is an invitation to the intensive. But I don't want you sharing the videos. I don't want you sharing the videos. So we're setting up some rules here. You got going forward. See, in the 60s, it was all about no rules, no authority. Guess what? That didn't work. It was a disaster. So we're not doing that again. We're going to have authority. We're going to have rules. We're going to have guidelines. We're going to do it the right way this time. Otherwise, our tombstone will say, "Here lies an idiot who didn't learn the lessons of history," and end up doomed themselves to repeat them. And who wants that on their tombstone, you know? Not me. Not me. So I'll do it, and we'll see who else will do it. We'll see who else will do it, right? So we're just starting to, you know, get clear about, okay, how we're going to do this. Very great. That's probably it for this video, because it's reached the magic 4 gigabyte mark. Very great. So I'm fired up. This is wonderful. We're making progress here. Making a lot of progress. All blessings. It's still going, but it'll stop. It'll stop at some point. It always seems to stop at some point here. At about this time, 4 gigabytes is supposed to be the limit. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. So you're going to have, rightfully so, use those who commit to doing this 2-month intensive, you're going to have access. Free. I'm not charging anything. Okay, free, but it's not going to be available to the public, because they can't handle this. As it gets too sublime, they start wanting to turn it into a commodity. I got to turn this into a commodity. I got to do it. I got to do it. I got to find it. I got to, you know. No commodities. No commodities now for this 2 month period. We're not going to turn any of this into a commodity. You stay with the abstraction. You stay with it's freely given, but it's not available to the public at large. It is not available to the public at large. I'm not going to do anything like that that's available to the public at large right now. We have to turn very clearly and adamantly towards how to manage our success, how to manage our euphoria that's coming up, or depression, you know, despair. Either way, we have to have spiritual success. We have to know how to manage our success. So we're on the road to that already. You can see the commitment. You make the commitment, the ideas come. And so I feel in a much better position now than I was before. I was wondering, you know, how can we do this? So it's coming into light now. I've kind of been getting into a little bit of it going forward. I think Susan also had, I gave previews and videos for her. Say, what do you think about this? You know. So you're already used to that. Some of you are already used to that. A few of you are already used to getting some links to videos I've given you, right? So probably we're going to be going forward in that way. And then some more contact on the surface. That's a way to get into it. That's a reasonable way to get into it. So I'll still be publicly active in some way, maybe on Facebook and YouTube, etc. And then there'll be this other layer to my availability to this, for those who commit to this 2-month intensive, which consider it. I ask everyone to really consider it, because if you turn it over to reason will say, wow, this I have to do this, because I have to know how to manage the future, whether it be bad or great. It's going to be one or the other, right? It's not just going to be, those days are over. Those days are over. The politics of right now, it's boom or bust, all or nothing. Right? Either they're going to gain control over us, or we're going to reestablish our freedom or something. It's going to be drastic, whatever happens. It's going to be drastic one way or the other. So you better know how to ride that horse. you better know how to ride that horse. It's going to be a powerful horse you're on. It's going to be a Ferrari you're driving, okay? You got to know how to, I warned everyone, you got it, that Ferrari in your driveway, you got to have to know how to drive it. That's why Juan Carlos, I introduced Juan Carlos, he knows how to drive the Ferrari. Listen to Juan Carlos. That may be one of the series I have, and you'll be clued into this. You know, how are we doing it? We're doing it in an artful way, in a playful, artful way, okay? It's not just lecturing, you know, lecturing. We're more skilled than that right now. You know, all praise to those who have their traditions, but we're in the tradition of skillful artfulness, actually, here. I'm a skilled artist. Skilled creative artist, actually. With a lot of know-how and practice in quite a few areas. Including video making now. You know, music, graphics, video making, all those three, you know. I'm skilled in all that, but also know how to keep it simple too, and go fast. So this is still recording, which is kind of interesting. Maybe with this new, I put a new memory disk actually. Oh, this is interesting. I bought a new memory card. It's a 64 gigabyte, super high speed transfer, like 10 times faster. Maybe it doesn't have a 4 gigabyte limit or something on its recording. Or I don't know how this is working, but this has gone over the 4 gigabyte limit. That's amazing. So maybe we can have longer videos than 2.5 hours, which is could be helpful for our intensive, right? As again, you're going through the seasons, right? The holiday season. It's already, people already have their Christmas stuff going up, you know, before Thanksgiving now. And I know not all countries have Thanksgiving, but it's the holiday season around the world for many people, right? For many. Not for everyone. But it's a make or break time. Make or break time. You don't want to gain a lot of weight, so I'll have physical exercise, diet tips, the whole thing, nutritional stuff. How do you keep your life under control for the next 2 months so you don't sink, for sure? You don't want to sink during these next 2 months. I mean, it's possible that those who don't take the intensive and are in a lot of stress, you might sink. It's very possible that you might sink. The danger is there. This holiday season is you just might overdo it with the food, with the drink, lack of sleep, with the stress, with the entertainment, and you hit the new year and the inauguration comes, and you might just mentally lose it, actually. You lose your confidence and become fanatic. Turn into a fanatic. And the stress, can't sleep, and you get swept up by the activists, and next thing you know, you're the problem. You become part of the problem. And then you lose your confidence and you get depressed. Start taking heavy medications, develop all sorts of physical problems. Next thing you know, you're in the morgue. Okay? Yeah. You're in the morgue. Next thing, it happens fast. When you go downhill, you know, especially when you get older, it can happen fast. So, especially you boomers, okay? I'm speaking, you know, you boomers, you got to listen to what I have to say. And don't give me an attitude about it, okay? Because I've learned from your mistakes. I suffered from your mistakes. I learned from them. And so I'm saying, let's not make the same mistakes twice. Now, I'm the authority, okay? I'm leading the situation now. Not the boomer. You're not the authority anymore. You're the ones that now need the help, okay? And I respect everything you've done greatly. I made it very clear that I benefited from everything you've done. But now the shoe's on the other foot, okay? So, and I'm not so far removed from you. I'm 1956, so not that I don't understand. I understand very well, okay, very clearly what you've been through, very, very clearly. And again, I love and respect all of that. But at some point now, you know, someone, you know, steps up who has the right stuff, and that's how it is. So don't rebel against authority. That phase is over. You know, all this, oh, Trump. What you're saying is, I hate authority. Come on, that's finished. You don't have to put faith in Trump, but you better follow some authority, or you're going to, again, end up in the morgue or become part of the problem, which is the very thing you wanted to avoid in the first place, right? And you're in very much danger of those two options right now. So we'll see what happens. I think boomers have a very much trouble doing that. You know, I've never had baby boomers look at me like I should have any authority. They're the ones telling me what to do. And I've always been told what to do by the boomers, right? But that's now coming to an end. It's coming to an end, and you just have to realize that that's over. It's over. The election of Trump finished it. We're into a new phase now, and boomers are having terrible trouble with that. That's why you got to be careful about Facebook. I mean, they're just screaming. They're just crying like little babies, you know? They can't handle it. Other people around the world, they're handling it so much better. You know, it's just amazing how the rest of the world's handling it. But I'm telling you, the rest of the world, America's not handling it well. The boomers are not handling it well. They're just going into hysteria. Just, you know, their immaturity is showing. I mean, we got extreme problems here, and they just trying to pretend that everything's perfect because they got their nice little, you know, wealth nest egg, and they want the rest of their lives to just everybody to kind of say how great they are, you know? And it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen, boomers. We're not going to spend the rest of our lives telling you how wonderful you are and how you changed the world and made it all perfect for us, because you screwed it up royally. And you turned us to the devil, really. All the while thinking that, no, we're everything's great. No. You put us on the abyss of a total fascist state, a total so Marxist state, actually, of technocratic control. You delivered us into the jaws of the shark. So you failed. You screwed up. It's time you take your medicine. So you're not going to get the rest of us praising you and giving you the little life that you thought the next 20 years of your life from 60, you know, 61 to 81 or so, no, 25, 86, let's say, the next 25 years of your life are not going to be the golden years that you planned on, okay? Not at all. Because nobody, the younger generation's not going to kiss your ring at all. And you know, the rest of us aren't going to be kissing your ring, and I'm not going to be. And the gurus are not going to be kissing your ring. I mean, they came to me, Longchenpa came to me, okay? And I'm telling you now that this is how it is. This is how it is. And I know you don't like it. You hate it. You still think that you're something. You're not. You're not. You screwed up. You failed. You made a great effort, but you failed. So now the question is, are you going to take the next step and own up to that and be honest with yourself and say, I didn't know how to manage my success. I was an idiot. But there's some saw that, my failure, and said, wow, I got to help them at some point. Out of compassion, saying they're going to screw up. They screwed up. Yeah, you did. And now you got an opportunity to set it right. Now you got an opportunity to get down to business. Okay, so it's up to you. It's up to you what you do. But don't think that you're going to push anybody around at this point. You know, it's called humility at this point. And we'll see if any of them show up at all. I don't know, maybe zero will. You know, I don't know. I hope not. I hope some will. I hope some will realize, hey, got a new sheriff in town here. And, you know, stop all this Trump crying, blah, blah, as if Trump's going to push me around or the gurus. And Trump's not going to push me around. He's not going to push the gurus around at all. Okay. And I don't think he'd even try. He's not stupid. And if he does, then he's got a problem. Okay. I'll just say, Don, let's go play golf and I'll set you straight. He's a boomer himself, I think, is he not? Right. I don't know when he was born. I think, what is he, 70? He was born in, what, 46 then? Something like that. He's a boomer. Okay. So he thinks he's going to set everything right. And he might set a lot right. The boomers are very amazing, okay? They really are. Except they have one severe weakness that they don't know how to handle their success at all. They're very bad at that. It's like they can take one step, they can't take the second step. I'm able to take both steps, okay? But I realize the second step is more important, so I emphasize the second step. I don't have it backwards. I have it the right way. First, you're willing to wow whatever arises, then the success arises. You don't first have this success and then say, okay, what do I do about it? That's backwards. It lacks faith. See, I have faith in success already. So I say, I know I'm going to be successful. So I'm focused on being absolutely determined to do absolutely nothing about my clarity that arises until I get familiar with it, until it sinks in, it settles, and becomes familiar with it. I'm not going to do anything. So it's the opposite of activism. I'm not going to do anything. I'm committed to doing absolutely nothing. And when you're committed to that, guess what? Tremendous spiritual clarity arises for you. And you say, oh my gosh, that's completely changed the total, my total world of expectations, which is our world, actually. We don't realize that our world is the world of our expectations. We live in a world of our own expectations. I don't know. I don't know how much of an idiot Trump's going to be. I don't. He might be an idiot, he might not. All the boomers are projecting their own idiocy onto him. You're an idiot, Trump's an idiot. Yeah. Now what they mean is, they're afraid their own idiocy is going to be exposed. And again, I find that other people from other countries are wiser about this than most Americans. It's really something. The boomers are so caught up in their own narcissistic belief in how successful they've been that they just can't handle realizing that they're idiots. And it's, you know, they're projecting their idiocy onto Trump. Other people around the world, they could see that. Wise people, they say, oh, well, stop crying. Election's over. Come on, get back to your spiritual practice. What are you guys doing? You know, they look at us like, what the heck's the matter with you? They're right, okay? The boomers are just projecting their own idiocy onto Trump because they're fearful he'll bring it to light. He'll say, what are you patting yourself on the back for? Look, you screwed everything up. Let's get to work, fix it. They're saying, no. We've got it exactly the way we want it to be. Sure, anybody can just come into this country. No checks on anybody. And they can take all our jobs. No problem. We fixed everything. The boomers, all I think is, we fixed everything. No, you didn't. Are you abiding in pure consciousness? No. So you haven't fixed everything. Are you totally free of absurdity? No. So you're not free of severe continuity fear. You're not free of it. Are you a Dharma King? No. Well, then you haven't fixed everything. You haven't fixed your own life at all. And if you can't fix your own life, you live in a world of your own expectations, you're part of the problem still. You're part of the problem still. But they're trying to rest on their laurels because they're getting older. They say, well, I don't have the push, so I got to just try to take this position and I just hope we get Clinton in there and we'll just yuck our way to the morgue. It didn't happen. God bless it didn't happen. And thank God it didn't happen. And it gave you another chance, boomers. So you should be on your knees thanking God that you have another chance for another push here. Except this time it's going to be different and you're not in charge. Okay, you're not in charge anymore. The gurus are in charge this time. And you're not going to big time the gurus this time around. Okay? That's finished. So you get to have 25 years of humility. And you know, if you do that, you will not return to this world. Okay? You will be on the path to abidance. All right? And you'll look back and say, I had a fantastic life. What a successful life I had. I learned how to manage my spiritual success. That's the opportunity in front of you right now. And the younger people, not many of them will get with it, let's be honest. Some will, but they have their own thing. They want to have a technocracy, okay? They think they can handle that. They don't think it's handling them. They think it is handling them. They're being handled. Okay. the machines are in control of them. But the boomers, they're not that way, actually. So, you know, I will see what happens. I don't know what will happen. The boomers have a lot of money. They can help out. They can help push things forward. We'll see if they use it that way or not. Maybe they won't give a penny, as they have not yet given a penny, actually. Because they say, oh, no, I'll only help out those who will help me yuck it up through my next 25 years and pat me on the back and say, yeah, you fixed the world. You made it perfect. Aren't you awesome saints, you know? Instead of, you know, you screwed everything up. You're idiots. However, you can redeem that. You can redeem it. You can redeem it. You can redeem your life, boomers. You're not done yet. You're not done yet by a long shot. Stop this stupid activism. You keep thinking, no, I just want to turn it back and so everybody, you know, tells me how great I am. You know, no, you're not. You need to be activist in how to manage your success. Activist in being humble is what you need activism for now. Okay, so it's my turn to talk. I was silent for 50 years, you know, basically, while you ran the show. So that silence is over now. So I'm part of running the show now. And you're part of paying attention to the show, right? In the right way, in a humble way. In a humble way. And you just can't, you know, throw this stuff at me and intimidate me anymore. Ah, Tibet, and I went to visit Tibet, and, you know, I visited Tibet, I visited Nepal, and Kathmandu, yeah, I met a guru there, I bought back these tonkas, you know, I hung up these tonkas in my room, you know, I burned some incense, yeah, I know some stuff about Tibet, but yeah, you can't intimidate me, though, it's over, it's finished. Yeah, I went to some Hindu guru, blah, 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 blah. I visited Arunachala, yeah, okay, well, wow, yeah, okay, it's finished. So that's great. It's great for you that you've come up upon this obstacle now in your life of Trump and then me, which is even greater obstacle. Because I won't put up with any nonsense. You know, you've got to be humble and say, I've got some work I got to do still. And it's not going to be my way. Because I don't know how to do it, really. I've never been taught. I've never been shown. I don't really know how it's really done. Because I wanted to try to tell everybody how it's done. You know, that kind of boomer thing. Like, we're going to tell everybody how it's done. So it's kind of a mixture. Like, yeah, you got a little bit of it, but I'm going to tell you, you know, also how, you know, we think it should be done. How we think it should be done. So we can, you know, have everyone praise us how great we are. No, it's not done that way. It's done through discipline and determination and will. And humility. And steady determination. Okay? So, you may not be gallivanting around the world as you thought you would be. Thank God for that, you know. Thank God for Trump. You know what? You should just say, every morning, say, thank God Trump was elected. Saved me. Because I'm not just going to be this slothful idiot for the rest of my life. Which is, all you boomers, you're slothful idiots, tell you the truth. You really are. You haven't really gotten after it. Yeah, I did a Zen retreat for a couple of years. Oh, so what? Then you went back and made your millions, right? It doesn't impress anymore at all. I don't care what you've done. If you don't know how to manage your success, you haven't done enough. But I'm super kind. I've been kind my whole life to the boomers. I've bowed to them and done everything they told me to do. I'm very kind to everybody and very playful and very creative and all that. But there has to be, you know, we got to set things on the right foundation. You can't build a house on a wrong foundation. It won't stand. And so this authority problem has to be resolved here. And, you know, we have to resolve this authority problem going forward, or else you won't go forward at all. You'll still be singing the tune, calling the tune. And we're not dancing to your tune anymore. Because it was the wrong tune. And this is how it works. But again, I'm very much appreciative and in touch, and I can speak your language and all this kind of stuff. That's the boomers. And the younger generation, I can also speak tech language. You know, I have an appreciation of all that too. Okay, and you need to understand, just because you can throw some code in my face doesn't mean anything. Okay, doesn't mean anything. Just because you're technologically sophisticated, well, I could use all this technology too if I wanted to. Certainly, I'm showing I'm capable of doing it. Okay, doesn't mean anything. Doesn't make you any authority at all, because that's not the goal. The goal is how to manage our spiritual success. And I don't know, the technocrats, they have also not, you know, they're really high hat, aren't they? They're so high hat. And in Silicon Valley, no one in the Silicon Valley has ever been humble towards me at all, you know, and said, hey, maybe you know something. Nobody. These tech people think they're here to run the world. You know, they're morons. I call them tech morons. Again, they have no clue of what it's about. So don't die an idiot. That's the worst thing ever. Die as stupid as you came in. You know, leave the world as stupid as you came in, because you bungled the most important part. You were so much after your success, you forgot that the most important part is wisely managing your success. And that takes expertise and authority and help, because very few know how to do this. Very few have done it. It's very difficult, as far as, because nobody, we're unfamiliar with it. It's easy to do, but the lack of familiarity freaks us out. So, I can't do this, I don't know what to do. What do you mean, full stop of the way? I sit there, quiet, you know, get all jittery, you know? So apparently this memory card, which I was sent into the store for something, and they were out of it, and I was leaving the store, I suddenly saw this half-off sale with memory chips. I said, wait a minute. I wonder if I could use that. I didn't have my debit card with me, and so I couldn't buy it. I got to the cashier and said, I can't pay for it. So I went back later, and I got it, and I'm trying it in the computer now, and it's allowing us to go beyond the 4 gigabyte mark. So it was a limitation of the memory chip card and not the program. Isn't that something amazing? So we have come across a discovery here that's quite extraordinary. Wow. This opens up some avenues for me, actually. To do some more multimedia presentations, there's a way. I have a program, Ustream or something, where I can record longer videos with graphics and stuff put in there, and I can make them quite long. And this would, like, really just, we need to be just this feeling of, like, you know what, immersion is possible. Immersion in the sublime is possible. And as you get these seamless presentations, that starts sinking into you. You say, hey, maybe it is possible. Whereas Facebook, click, 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 click. You know, that's overconfidence. You know, it's immersion and fragmentation. Okay? And that's absurdity. Absurdity tells you, no, you can be immersed in fragmentation. That's fine. It needs to be smoothed out, more smoothed out. And so, like, the videos that are just, you know, seamless, they keep going. If you discipline yourselves, you find, hey, you know what? Maybe I can be in the sublime all the time. Maybe it doesn't need to be this raggedness of back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Maybe it can be sublimely smooth for me. And so this starts working on you, and you start gaining some confidence that, hey, wait a minute. And so you start aiming higher. I love the videos I work on and edit. You know, it's just, they're so, I'm so thankful that I got the GoPro, and that woke me up to something. And I don't even use the GoPro for all of it. I'm still not sure how to use it. It's I will get there, you know. I always do. It's the other camera I have, I do most of the work on that, because the color's better, and Yeah, zoom. The GoPro has no zoom. This is really something. Because it's an action camera. You can't be zooming while you're riding your bike. You know, so the idea is, hands off. The GoPro, you don't touch it. It's mounted somewhere. Fixed mount. And then you're doing all the stuff. That's the idea behind the GoPro. It's fixed mount. But I don't use it that way so much. I will do some. I will use it some way. You know, in some ways I will do that. But I discovered something I can use it for yesterday, actually. Which is pretty cool. Really cool. So I have special effects, but this stuff is very sublime and requires a very advanced viewer who can handle their success, right? So the thing is, this produces a reaction in you, okay? And you have to be committed to the full stop and the wow practice to do this. And for years I've been putting it out, full stop and wow, and very few are paying attention. But I said, boy, if you don't pay attention to this, there's going to come a time when I have more sublime material and you're not going to have access to it. You know, this is, you know, like I just warned people, say, hey, you got to learn this. But you, if you're really motivated, you can do it. It's just, wow, don't define the success that arises. When you watch these videos, then you have to spend some time cooling down from them. Don't just go right into Facebook, click, 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 click. No, you can't do it that way. You've got to say, I'm not going to do anything. I'm just going to sit here quietly and wow, that just blew my mind what I just saw. And no sex, no drugs, no entertainment, okay? Absolutely cannot. Including caffeine. You cannot view these videos on caffeine or nicotine. No smoke, no nicotine, no caffeine. Those are the rules of the road. You know, I can't force you into that. But you got to be wise about it. You know, I understand that people always love breaking rules, don't they? But I'm saying that the benefits will not be there for you. It'll diminish the benefits. And you're using drugs as a way of full stop and wow. In the 60s, we tried that. It doesn't work. Obviously, I mean, okay, we're in a terrible situation in the world now because we didn't know how to handle our success properly. You cannot use sex, you cannot use drugs, you cannot use entertainment to manage your success on the path. Okay, you cannot do that. Period. 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 So, you know, I mean, I think I have to ask people before I give them links to these videos, you know, are you committed to the rules of the road? Are you committed to driving that Ferrari? You're going to be driving a Ferrari. I'm a Ferrari, okay? I really am. There's no doubt about it. I've proved it to myself. You know, as far as singing-wise, I'm a super Ferrari. But will I sing for people or not? I don't know. If they're committed to the rules of the road, I might do a little bit. Maybe not. I don't know. I love hearing myself. I blow my own mind vocalizing. I'm just like, are you kidding me? That was so cool, what I just heard. That was so amazing and soulful. You know, it's just, wow. Sing some more, please. Dear Mr. Fantasy, sing us all a tune. Something that'll make us all happy. Just don't turn into a commodity. So I'm Mr. Fantasy, as far as singing goes. And video, too. I mean, both. I have both. But it's like, it's, you know, I'm the Ferrari, but if you want to drive the Ferrari, you got to commit to the rules of the road. And you need to say, no, no sex, no drugs, no rock and roll. Certainly, surrounding the time of your spiritual practice, okay? So there has to be a bubble when you're watching the videos, and after watching the videos, that stuff is absolutely off limits. You are simply, you're pure, you're clear, you're not hyped up, you're discerning. And then after you watch the videos, also you have that phase like a couple hours after where, you know, you are just quiet. You're quiet. You're letting the shock settle down. You're letting the shock settle down. So we'll see what we can do. I think we might even be at the 3-hour mark. Yeah, we're already past the 3. We're at the 3:03. I can just keep going, you know. I mean, I can vocalize all day. Which is a lot more strenuous than what I'm doing right now, talking. You know, singing, vocalizing, singing harmony, powerful harmony. But it does take your toll. I can't do it just continuously week after week. You know, you get run down at some point. So we're establishing the rules of the road here. And then that'll free me up to make really sublime videos, because I'm reaching the point where I'm starting to get nervous about this. I've gotten some heads up and warnings about all this. And you just can't put this stuff in front of anybody, actually. The shock is so severe that then they go into a regressive reaction, and their idiocy gets drawn to light. So wait a minute, I've been really stupid. Oh my gosh, that's great, but wait, I don't know how to handle my success. Hey, Trump, you're an idiot, you know. We're gonna destroy you. You're such an idiot. You're a maniac. You're gonna destroy the world. They start projecting all that stuff, you know, and they start getting into activism, and they lose their minds. You know, we don't want that. We don't want any of you losing your mind at all. We want you all to be very immaculate, very contained, very immaculate, very free-flowing and smooth, but in a very appropriate way, in a mindfulness way, okay? And you might say, I only want a fellow boomer tell me what to do. No, because they're too indulgent, right? How have they helped you? They're too indulgent. Boomers are too indulgent of themselves. Like I said, I'm not really a boomer. Just right on the edge, 1956, born 1956. So I'm way more strict and not so indulgent of you, you know, which is a good thing. It's a really good thing. You know, all these little tricks you pull, you know, say, no, it doesn't work with me. Yeah, but I had the guru. Well, great. It helped you out, but they were too indulgent. Yeah, they smile at all the fornication and the drugs and all this kind of stuff and say, yeah, it's all cool. You know, they think, oh, what a great guy, a great gal. You know, they understand us, you know. They understand us, Bill Clinton types, you know, like that. Not me. I understand it, but I don't condone it. It's the end of fornication, you know, it's the end of your fornication. It's the end of your drugs. It's the end of your rock and roll, you know. Time for you to drive the Ferrari now and listen to a real musician, maybe, right? And listen to, you know, someone who's been on the immaculate path and the path of purity. Listen to the Ferrari, the pipes of the Ferrari. Listen to that roar, right? And just say, wow. When you hear that, you just say, wow. Don't go back into commodity, you know, and say, oh, I got to make a commodity, man. You know, how do we do this? You know, how can I do this? No. Just wow it. Not how can I do it. Just wow it. Your job is to wow it. You don't see Longchenpa and say, well, how can I do this? I got to do this. I got to figure out, you know, give me my guitar. No. You say, wow. Just that. Just to wow it. When you are committed to wowing, guess what? You come in contact with the sublime. And guess what, boomers? Woodstock isn't the sublime, okay? It never was. It never was. So, get that and say, okay, I deserve the sublime. Say, I deserve the sublime. But in order to get it, I've got to wow it. That's the rule. That's it. You don't wow it, you don't get it. You got to be committed to wowing it when it arises for you. And don't cop some attitude. No, you're just, this is, you were wowed, okay? 360 degree wowed. Praise it and accept it. Praise it and accept it. So, this is great. We're off to a roaring start right here. And the weather has just turned terrible right here, right now. I'm freezing. It's miserable. Yeah, it's miserable. Okay, very great. Very great. So, full stop in the wow. Blessings to everyone. And this is going to take place in one way or the other. And again, if no one participates, no one participates. I will participate. So, if you're participating, you know that at least I'm participating, right? So I'm setting the example. If no one follows, I still set the example. That's what a Dharma Prince does. Dharma Prince does not follow the crowd. Dharma Prince sets the right example, and that's what they do. That's what they do. Very great. That's it. How we got to 5 gigabytes. Boom.